two of the biggest names in college football. Tennessee senior quarterback Peyton Manning, the son of an All-America quarterback, holder of 37 school SEC and NCAA records, and the favorite to win college football's most prestigious award, the Heisman Trophy. Flash forward to Kentucky sophomore quarterback Tim Couch, now holder of 22 Kentucky and SEC records, and to many, next year's favorite to win the Heisman Trophy. Today, in their annual battle for the beer barrel, Manning and Couch will square off in their only collegiate duel. It's the hottest ticket in the Southeast today as a record crowd awaits the battle of these two teams and quarterbacks at Commonwealth Stadium. Of dollars for his senior year. He hopes for a storybook finish. But today, Manning meets the heir apparent throwing the football. That being sports of Kentucky. How big is this game? Better than 2,000 portable seats have been brought in for what will be the largest crowd in the history of the Commonwealth for a college football game. On Senior Day, a November Saturday they'll not soon forget, the Bell South SEC Game of the Week, the border rivalry between number... Kentucky home has been... of having championship season. Crowd the biggest they've ever had for a football game here in Lexington. Dave Rowe and to our fans, that no two individual players are more focused upon in college football than the
rule of thumb that you blitz a bad quarterback or against. It's definitely a cover day. With double coverage on the wide receivers, you both find them.
I think there are a great. Today. Dave Rowe, Tim Brando, happy to have you here in the Bluegrass. The third member of our broadcast team today is Chip Carter down on the sidelines.
Hey, Tim, thanks a lot. Here's the situation. Al Wilson, the linebacker for Tennessee, comes into this game with a badly sprained ankle. He's going to dress out, but they don't think he's going to play. If he doesn't go, that changes the role that Leonard Little plays a little bit. He won't be able to flip-flop between the defensive line and that middle linebacker spot as much as Phil Fulmer would like to be able to see him do. He'll have to stay at the MLB position. on Kentucky's defensive side. Here's a matchup you've got to watch. Cornerback Tony Woods versus Tennessee's Marcus Nash. Nash has had two back-to-back 100-yard receiving games. Hal Mumme says Tony Woods is a guy with the best raw talent in the secondary, but he lacks consistency at times, so keep an eye on him.
All right, Chip, thank you. Hal Mumme in his first year. Born in San Antonio, played wide receiver at Thomas Jefferson High in Dallas, spent a couple of years at New Mexico Military Institute, and then finished up at Division II Tarleton State. He has now become an icon in this state.
Absolutely. Boy, they love him here, and it's witnessed by this crowd, Tim. This is an incredible crowd. They've been here for an hour.
Philip Fulmer in his sixth year. All he's done is win 83% of his games. Red White on there to make the stop. As you look at Tim Couch, remarkable season he has had. 66% completion rate. Touchdown. He will call at the line 70% of these plays with checkoffs. But the first 15 plays, in fact, most of this game is scripted by Mumme. Quick drop. Bread and butter play, if you'll pardon the cliche, for this Kentucky offensive football team. As you look at our Nation's Bank starting lineup, and Yeast is... about 2 yards shy of the first down. As we look at the Tennessee defense, Jonathan Brown leading the SEC in sacks.
And Bill Duff, real good up front, solid. Green and Terry, really interesting. You're going to play two linebackers, and they're going to play a nickel defensive back with Terry Fair. Really has a lot of pressure on him today. He has three interceptions, but we're going to watch that matchup today. The big matchup will be, of course, the Tony Woods against Nash on defense for Kentucky.
Noel, by the way, Noel, the nickel back in there where Al Wilson would have been, as Chip Carter mentioned at the outset. There's that quick hitch.
And that's good presence of mind by the wide receiver. He knew exactly how far he had to get for that first down, and he reached forward with the ball to break the plane of that first down.
Corey Terry there to make the stop.
Now, see, Sanford's on the line. He comes back for the football, breaks the tackle there. Good run out there. That was a good run out block there to pick him off.
First down, 10, Kentucky. Opening drive. Junior college transfer that had been planning to go to BYU, which, by the way, this offense of Hal Mumme's is very influenced by Lavelle Edwards and the BYU program. He spent some time, of course, in the WAC and got to know Lavelle Edwards very well. He's always looked up to him. But Mickelson is a player that went to Snow College, and everyone from Snow College has wound up at BYU except this young man. He meandered to Kentucky. Wide receivers.
He was. He looked up, saw the defense, knew exactly where to go. That's what they have to do all day long. As he just comes up here, drops back, throws, just bang. He's got such great arm strength. He knew exactly where to find his wide receiver in the slot, wide open. I think the loss of Al Wilson is really going to hurt Tennessee today.
That's a tremendous example of it. You're right, Dave. Aaron Clark and Jimmy Haley, twin tight end. Look, this...
play. It's interesting. Jonas Leaning, number 64. Everybody in Kentucky is standing, including us. Three wide receivers. One thing, that is what Kentucky has got to do today. They've got to keep the pressure off Tim Couch.
Today, the football will be in the air. Our score 7-0 Kentucky. On that drive, 7 plays, 4 out of 5 in the air, 64 yards for Couch.
Well, Couch, watch the presence in the pocket. He just moves around, doesn't look downfield, comes off onto Homer, and a good block by Kevin Coleman, number 19 on the play, and that has got right there. You see Homer break into the free, but you should have seen Couch on the sideline jumping up. Look at this, running downfield, tremendous.
Coleman was the primary receiver, yeah. And then when he went for the secondary receiver, Homer, Coleman, the roommate of Couch, made the key block to spring the touchdown.
Certainly did. You see there, 7 plays, 84 yards. Time of possession. We talked about that being a big key. Kentucky kept the football for over 3 minutes.
Goodrich on the return. Stopped at the 21-yard line for Tennessee. That's where the Volunteers will take over as you look at Peyton Manning, senior from Newman High School, New Orleans. One of 19 scholar-athletes chosen to receive a postgraduate fellowship by the National Football Foundation and the College Hall of Fame. He will be so honored on December 9th, one of the many honors yet to be bestowed upon him. And all the pressure on his coach that we mentioned earlier, Philip Fulmer, it's been given to him on a platter to some extent by Florida losing. Tennessee has to win out. That's Sean Bryson. And Bryson continues to break tackles up to near midfield.
Boy, that's what Peyton Manning does so well, as he finds the uncovered receiver. We talked about the matchup today, Tony Woods against Nash, but there's going to be somebody open, and you see right there Manning sees him. Wide open out of the backfield is Sean Bryson, and he just puts his head down right here and just runs over. He just keeps those legs going. You know, Tim, I was thinking, if we just have an average game, we'll have over 60 points.
Nickel defensive package for Kentucky here. Manning with time. Plenty of it. Jamal Lewis gets away from Snediger and barrels ahead to the 42 of the Big Blue. Another very large gain. They are doubling Marcus Nash today.
Yeah, this is their go-to guy. Try to jam him on the line. You see the double coverage come on him. Just staying right with him all the way. That's Littleton Ward. He's an excellent corner, number 4. He's just stuck to him just like glue. They know what he's going to do. They know they're going to go to him a lot.
Second down and 1. Well, we'll call it 2. It's a long one.
There's an audible on the line.
3-step drop, and the quick curl is complete. That's Jermaine Copeland, who has made a number of circus catches today. Throughout this season, Jermaine Copeland has been outstanding.
Well, you look at this Vol offense. Their 3 wide receivers are outstanding, and then they have Jamal Lewis, the bulk, the tailback in the back. The line is a solid line. Not a whole lot of preseason hype, but Chad Clifton has really played well, as has Trey Teague in the middle. He's been the solid rock.
Tennessee likes to run to their left behind both Clifton and Spencer Riley, the left guard.
See, there's Manning again making an audible on the line.
Got his his mitts on it. It was intended for Marcus Nash. And Jeff Snediger, a converted quarterback, leading the Wildcats defensively.
Well, this defense has got a lot of pressure on them. They know they can only play about 60 plays. Holmberg in the middle has got to be strong. The defensive secondary is really where the answers are. Can they cover him? Can Tony Wood stay with Marcus Nash all day? Can Ward be solid on the outside? A lot of questions there on the Wildcat defense.
Second down and 10. Hillis Price, the wide receiver, to the bottom of your screen. Manning looking for Price. On the post, he had a step on Tony Woods. Manning led him a bit too far.
Well, I saw that little bit of pressure that time by Anwar Stewart, number 55. They've got to get pressure up the middle. You'll see late pressure come right there. Manning has to unleash it a little bit early. 55 Stewart in his face. Big down here. Third down, and you'll know it from the press.
44% in third down conversion so far this year for Tennessee. Extra defensive back for Kentucky. Intended for Nash, tipped into the air. Willie Gary had illusions of grandeur. And it's fourth down coming up.
Well, a little bit of pressure again on Manning. They get a little bit of a burst up the middle. It's Stewart again, number 55, makes him pull the ball a little bit quick. This just goes off the fingertips of Nash.
Well, Wesley, though, gave him a bump, didn't it?
Yeah, certainly did. Wesley's trying to jam him on the line. He's the outside backer. He's going to have coverage all day long in his face.
Lee Wesley, number 34, sophomore from Campbellton, Florida.
Boy, this is going to be a long field goal. This is almost 50 yards.
Jeff Hall, 49 yards officially out of the hold of Benson Scott, son of Bobby Scott, the ex-Tennessee All-American. Got it through. Tennessee on the board as the youngster from Winchester. His previous long had been 47. That's his longest field goal of the year. And you have to get into a pitch and catch and scoring match against Mummy's team, particularly when you're playing in Lexington, KY. 7-3, our score. As Jeff Hall connects back after a word from your local SEC station. 7-3, our score, Kentucky, and already we've seen, Dave, the air raid that we anticipated in both series.
Unbelievable. 12 of 13 plays, all passes. We don't expect a big run day.
And, you know, the run that we saw was a reverse.
That's exactly right.
It wasn't a conventional off-tackle play.
That's a dangerous man returning kicks and punts, Craig East. As Hall, who just kicked the 49-yarder, boots it to him. From the two, Craig East. Could not quite make the corner, but a quality return beyond the 30-yard line. Tim Couch is trying his best not to make a big deal out of today's quarterback matchup. It's much more than that, according to the sophomore.
I really don't look at it like that. I think, it's more like me against Tennessee's defense and Peyton against Kentucky's defense. So, that's the way I'm looking at it, and I'm really not competing against him. I'm really going against people like Leonard Little, and, they're great defensive backs and things.
Tim is smart to mention that. You know that number two is thinking about number one wearing the orange and white, but he is 3 yards off the line of scrimmage with the loss of Al Wilson playing middle linebacker. With time, a wobbler. That one may have been tipped at the line of scrimmage. You know Couch doesn't release them in an end-over-end fashion.
No way.
East was the closest to it. Raynock Thompson appeared to be the man that got his big mitt up there. May have had some help.
I didn't see where it was tipped, but it was tipped along the line right there. You see Couch just hoping that it's going to get to the ground. That's who I think maybe it was Darwin Walker who tipped that football.
Second down and 10. Homer, the lone setback. And he gets it. Off tackle, he bursts ahead to the 40, maybe the 41-yard line, a couple of yards shy of a first down. Philip Fulmer, you asked both he and his defensive coordinator, John Chavis, you say, well, other than Couch, who's your greatest concern? And they'll tell you very quickly it's Derek Holman.
Well, exactly. You saw that run that time. Made a nice cut in the hole, found that little seam. He's got good vision into the hole. Big down here for Kentucky. They've got to keep this drive alive. Don't want to give the football back to Tennessee.
Couch does not like what he sees, and he'll call a timeout. One thing to remember about this team, they're always in four-down territory. You can always remember that. The youngster from Leslie County performed so admirably in high school, now trying to do it for his state school. Look at John Chavis, the gentleman to the far right of your screen, the defensive coordinator, grew up a UT man, has been a solid contributor for Philip Fulmer since he took over as head coach, and he's very pleased with what his defense has been able to accomplish.
Well, he certainly is. He's an outstanding coach, but his big concern this week was the loss of Al Wilson. Would he be able to play? Would he not be able to play? And it really changes the entire complexion of Tennessee's defense.
Homer has the first down. Ryan Green, number 55, the junior from Severna Park, Maryland, had a knee injury at the end of last year in to make the tackle. And this is a Tennessee defense that's three deep. I mean, they'll get them all in there.
Oh, yeah.
Late in this game, if there are a number of snaps, it's advantage to the Volunteers.
It certainly is. You know, we talk about Al Wilson, the loss of him at outside linebacker. You mentioned it keeps Leonard Little off the line as a rusher, and he's an outstanding pass rusher.
Coleman in motion for Couch. Tim will tuck it. Now, he can run and run very well. He has the first down inside the 40 to the 38-yard line. Perhaps the most overlooked attribute to Tim Couch, his speed.
Oh, yeah, and that's one of the things that the Tennessee coaches said to us. John Chavis said, I'm surprised at Couch's speed, as big as he is. Now, Leonard Little's the middle linebacker. On this play, he's got a drop for coverage. See him trying to pick up to the outside, take the slant right there. Now, he goes after a wide receiver. Now, he's got to pick back up trying to get Couch. If he's on the line, number one can run him down.
If you've got him reading and reacting and not rushing, that's an advantage for your offensive football team.
That's the loss of Wilson. That's what happens when you have Al Wilson lost this game.
Couch throwing the fade pattern for Yeast. Incomplete. Simply ran out of real estate inside the 15-yard line. Terry Fair, number 13, the senior from Phoenix, Arizona, over there to give chase.
Second and 10 for Kentucky.
Let's go down to Chip Carter.
Thanks, Tim. For the rain that we've had up here in Lexington, it rained all day yesterday, right into early this morning. The field is in really good shape. We walked it this morning. They're in the slipperiest part now. They're coming at it, the 25 to the 35, but they put Quick Dry on it, the stuff you see in gas stations that dries up oil, and this field is in good condition.
It really is. You see a little brown spot, though, right around where Leonard Little is located. That is the roughest area. Pass is caught. What a negligible gain for Keo Sanford at the 35-yard line. Number two, Fred White, the sophomore from Griffin, Georgia, right there to make the tackle.
Tim, look at Couch sitting back there. Come off his primary receiver. What great protection his line is giving him. This is the same line that, I mean, was much aligned last year. They give him time to sit back in there. They know they've got a pass protect, but they know they've got a star back there throwing.
Jimmy Haley, who's been injured somewhat this year, is coming at tight end. Lining up to the top of your screen. Third down and 7. And a check off at the line by Couch. Quick slant. It's there for Robinson. First down, Kentucky.
Boy, and the pressure mounts for John Chavis. Is he going to allow Tim Couch to stand back there, just look downfield and find his wide outs, or is he going to try to blitz him? Little missed tackle here on the tail play by Fred White. He's a strong safety. That frees him up to get an extra 4 or 5 yards. But they've got to do something to stop Tim Couch.
The other thing that they're doing with both the first drive and this one is they are maintaining possession of the football. Usually ball possession means very little to Hal Mumme. Today it really does.
Couch with time. Incomplete.
Pass thrown a bit too low for his college roommate Kevin Coleman, the junior from Knightsville, Florida. Did not come up with it.
Tim, I'm looking at the box, the tackle-to-tackle position, and there Tennessee has got 9 people from tackle to tackle, the offensive tackle. They are just crowding the ball. John Chavis knows that he's got to get pressure on Tim Couch. He's got a lot of people up, trying to get in there, trying to get some kind of a rush on Tim Couch.
This is the 8th play of the drive. Trips set, 3 wide receivers now. Robinson gives motion.
To a wide open Keo Sanford. He slipped, and the pass was thrown a bit behind him.
And it's incomplete.
Well, that's a catch that Sanford's got to come up with. It is thrown back against him.
as Chip said, that wet field, I think, may have played a part in this, because watch him. Number six goes across the middle. When he goes to reach back, watch his feet slip. See, he slips out from under him. It's a little bit wet down that area.
You know, we could see on that replay, Craig Yeast also gave a look at catching that pass. I think that may have obstructed his view of that particular pass, the one for Sanford.
Absolutely. And you see there, you see Hal Mummy signaling into Tim Couch.
He's had 5 men in the backfield. 5 yard penalty, still second down.
Well, late flag. Al Ford, our referee, letting us know. So that'll back him up 5 yards. Bud Williams is the linesman. You see the rest of our SEC officiating crew. So, second down and 15 from the 28 of Tennessee. Couch already with a touchdown pass to Derek Homer this afternoon.
As you say, this is 4 down territory for Kentucky.
Couch with time, now running out of it. That pass may have been picked off. Terry Fair says he's got it, and he does.
No, I thought the ball hit the ground. I think that's what Tim Couch is arguing. We'll see what the camera comes back, but I thought that football hit the ground in between.
He is arguing.
Boy, great move there by Fair. Left of your screen, you're going to see Fair come in. He's number 13. Watch the ball. See if it doesn't touch the ground. Right there. It's going down. Now watch right in here. Does it touch the ground? Yeah, it's on the ground. That ball is on the ground. Watch this ball again. Now, tail end of the ball. The ball has to be caught cleanly. Now watch where it's on the ground. Well, you can't see it really from that angle.
You can see it on our first angle.
Yeah, exactly.
Jamal Lewis up to the 23, maybe the 24-yard line. You know, I thought he had it initially, but as he was falling to the ground, he lost control but rolled over in time to keep the official from seeing that he had, in fact, lost it.
Well, this is it. Now watch the ball right here. Right there. It's on the ground.
Yeah.
That's an incomplete. That's what Couch was arguing about. Fair does a nice job, though, rolling over and holding the football
He
up.
Sold it, didn't he?
Yes, he did.
Second down and 4. Ahead for 2. Ian Lewis in the backfield together here in the opening moments of our game today. Stay tuned at halftime for our Bell South You Call the Play feature. A look at a big call from SEC Games Bank. Third down and 2. The 26. Out of the shotgun, Manning. Kentucky shows blitz. Now they back off. Bryson ahead for the first down.
Boy, wasn't that an interesting call? Out of a shotgun, 3rd down and 2, and they run a pass play.
Number 24, Sean Bryson.
Again, Peyton Manning in that shotgun. Now watch. The minute he gets the football, he rolls strong side. And you see, he picks him up out of the flat, finds Lewis out of the flat out there. And Lewis makes a nice catch to hold on to that football. That was Bryson.
One of the things we've noticed today is that Kentucky is forcing Manning to throw the football to the left. And that is what Mike Major, the defensive coordinator, really wanted to accomplish today. Force Manning to throw the ball to his left rather than his right. This time he looks right. Incomplete. Andy McCullough, the intended receiver, number 88, the senior out of Dayton, Ohio. We need to talk about the reasons why Major, and there you see Mike Major. He's got all of the one-liners of a Jerry Van Dyke as your defensive coordinator. Why he really wants to see Manning throw to his left.
They looked at film, and every team dissects film, and they felt that Peyton Manning, when he throws to his right, the outs, the shorts, and the long passes to his right, he's much stronger than when he throws to his left across his body. Now, that's a technical term, but that's really dissecting the film. When you think, and that's what they're going to do. They're going to try to force him to throw left. They think they have a better chance. They know they can't take everything away from him.
Lewis. And the power back.
Number 31.
Freshman from Douglas High in Atlanta, Georgia, to about the 40-yard line. Anwar Stewart, number 55, the sophomore from Panama City, Florida. Makes the tackle.
And Tim, this is wear them out time. If you're Tennessee, you want to wear down Kentucky's team. We talk about Kentucky's, they can last for so long. We talk about their depth. They're going to need a lot of enthusiasm for the crowd, but they don't let their defense out on the field more than 60 snaps.
After a turn.
turnover. They're trying for three and out here. Four wide receivers, three to the bottom of your screen. Manning dumps it. Nash has got it, and look out. Here comes the speed. Touchdown. Wesley and then set sail for 59 yards, and Major had the ball going to the left, but not enough speed to come up with Marcus Nash.
Well, when Nash gets out all by himself, he is such a deadly receiver, and he knows what to do with the football once he catches it. You know, there was almost a block in the back. One of the Tennessee players coming down trying to get in front of Jeremy Bowie almost got a hand in the back, but he just avoided it, just barely avoided it.
All with the extra point. So the controversial turnover leads to seven for Tennessee. And what we anticipate in being a true offensive showcase with 4:17 to play here in the opening quarter.
Well, again, Manning under a little bit of pressure. Late pressure right there. Finds Nash crossing pattern. Nobody's going to stay with him. What a good look right there. Now, you may see on the left of your screen there was that hand in the back. No, you don't see it right there. You see number 38 coming in. Jeremy Bowie, but Nash with that great speed. Again, crossing pattern, you can't give him this much time. You've got to get pressure on him. He finds Nash, cross the middle. Boy, it's just down the sideline. Look at that speed.
That's the play you were talking about.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was talking about.
And you're right. You were very fortunate not to have that ball against him.
Absolutely. That's what good teams do. They don't hurt themselves.
10th touchdown reception for Marcus Nash this year. The big arms now take their first lead at 10-7 over Kentucky.
Somehow you get the feeling it'll take more than 10 points to win this game.
Oh, boy. Let me tell you something. And like I said, if they just score, their average, there's going to be 60.
Number four, Jeff Hall.
Now, of course, it's Philip Fulmer's time. He's saying, wait a minute. Now, we got Couch coming back out there, and you see Couch warming up on the sideline. He wants to make up for that interception.
Fair catch called on the sky kick by Gary Davis. And that's where Kentucky will take over.
94, Gary Davis.
First down and 10. And again, field position at the 26-yard line as you look at the numbers on Couch. Now, the debatable interception leads to a touchdown for Tennessee. Mark that one down. Late in this game, in a very close game, if in fact it is, Tim Couch will not forget the play made by Fair that he truly believes, and the replay showed, was in fact not an interception.
Flag on the play before the play got going.
12 men in the huddle, more than 3 seconds.
That's the illegal substitution where you keep 12 men in the huddle for longer than 3 seconds. I think it was Kevin Coleman who ran out late. Well, you don't like that to start a series off.
Still not a bad life for Hal Mumme. Got a 5-year contract extension this week. At times like these, you have to remember such things.
Oh, amen.
Right?
Amen.
First down and 15. Feeling the pressure. Gets ahead. Maybe to the line of scrimmage or a yard beyond that. Torrey Noel.
Number nine.
Comes up with a stop. He's the fifth defensive back. A very big day in college football. This game's impact will echo through December. And in the ACC, Duke up on North Carolina. They're hoping for an alliance bid. And Ohio State, Michigan scoreless in the second as the Buckeyes try to return to sender. They've had their unbeaten season spoiled in the past by Michigan. Now they're trying to do the same for the Wolverines. Second down and 12. Bounce to Haley, his tight end. Only ahead for 3 yards. Raynock Thompson, number 46. Young man that is so strong. Has been playing this year with a bloody nose.
Spotted at the 28-yard line.
One of the toughest players ever recruited to Tennessee, according to John Chase. Sophomore out of San Augustine in New Orleans. They are perfect in third down conversions today, and this is a third and 8 that Couch faces.
Look for that little slot man, Kevin Coleman, number 19. He loves to come on that little crossing.
adjustment by Homer to come up with that catch in front of Fred White.
Did you see Homer's feet slip? When he came to the sideline and turned around, it looked as if his feet were almost going to slide out from under him. Number 42 out of the backfield, left of your screen. Watch the feet when he turns around right here. His feet kind of slip out from under him right in there. Just makes an outstanding catch against Fred White, number two. Look at that. Just gets great field position, and they keep this drive alive.
A tremendous recognition of where that pass was going by Homer. First down and 10. Still better than 2 minutes remaining in this first quarter. 2:45 to be exact.
Couch throwing the fade. Incomplete. That's the true freshman, Jermaine White, number 28.
They really believe he will be something special before his career is done. And with that man throwing passes to him, probably right.
Boy, and Couch over 100 yards already. We still have 2.5 minutes left in the first quarter. Oh, boy. I mean, they throw the football around. What an exciting offense. They just want to outscore you. That's all. They know they can't stop you a lot on defense, but they just say, hey, you give us the ball and we'll just outscore you.
It's a fast break on bluegrass. Just the way the people here like it. Couch. Running out of time now. Down he goes. And a late flag.
Boy, what was the flag for? Could it be a face mask? Because they were both thrown right where Couch went down.
Corey Terry, the first to get there, had a little help from Leonard Little.
Well, that's the thing that Philip Fulmer on his side has turned around saying, don't tell me that we just tackle him for a 7-yard loss and we get a face mask. He's hoping for a holding call against Kentucky.
That's the preliminary indication that we get. Doesn't believe that call.
Well, watch the tail end right there. There's the block in the back. You see the block right there? Now Little comes in late, just kind of covers him. But the block in the back may have been against Jason Watts, number 57, the center. See if he doesn't get that block in the back right in that area. That was maybe a good call. And it's in tight there, and it's tough for a block in the back within that tackle box, but that was a good call.
It's rare that you see that call against the center. Homer off the left side. Keeps his legs turning and is up to the 34-yard line. He is a very tough runner. The handoff from Mr. Football to Mr. Football in the state of Kentucky. Well, the last two in this state from 2 years ago, and of course last season, Derek Homer out of Fort Knox, Kentucky.
And I think if you're Hal Mumme, you're going to keep a lot of Mr. Footballs in Kentucky to play Kentucky football, because if you're an offensive player, you love it. Look at that, 4-4 on the third down conversion. They got a long one now, though. They got to go deep to make this first down.
Third down, 23. Dumps it. Nice play by number two, Fred White. Stuck his big mitt in there and got in front of Anthony White, the intended receiver. And Jimmy Carter will finally be called upon to punt.
Well, Fred White is coming in. He's the nickel back. He's number two. He plays because they took Torrey Noel and put him up in Al Wilson's spot, and he does a good job. He's got that one-on-one coverage. Back out of the backfield, Anthony White, number 32, and he just gets his hand in front of it.
Look at the difference in 96 to 97. A few fourth down go-for-its can keep you on the bench if you are a punter at Kentucky.
Man, you never know what might happen on a punt here with Kentucky. They're going to run out of time if they don't snap the ball in a hurry.
Normally, he angles for the sidelines. He does again here. Fair. Manages the 31, maybe the 32-yard line. Anwar Stewart, who is a very special talent, both defensively and on special teams. An 11-yard return after a 46-yard boot. 10-7 Tennessee, back downstairs to Chip Carter.
Hey, Tim, you know, Dave was saying that Jimmy Carter always punts it toward the sideline, and we were talking about how long yesterday. He said the only two times he's actually yelled at his punter when he's nailed it straight down the field, because he's that concerned about, obviously, their punt coverage. They don't want to get a return, an area that he thinks needs improvement, so they don't want to always go to the sideline with it.
And just give me an ugly punt that goes about 35 yards and has no return. Manning across the middle, incomplete. Intended
for Jermaine Copeland, and he should have come up with it.
Yes, he should have caught that football. One of the problems that Kentucky's going to have is the outweighing of on their defensive line compared to the offensive line of Tennessee. They've got to find a way to get pressure. They've got to do some stunts. They make up that difference in weight by doing a lot of flashes, gaps, doing little stunts on the line, bringing the tackles inside, the ends outside, looping out, trying to get pressure on Peyton Manning.
He's 5 out of 10 and better than 100 yards himself. Quick out for Peerless Price. Gets away from Woods. He juked him and got it up to midfield. That's an 18-yard gain.
Boy, the reason that Peerless Price is able to make this catch and make this move is the ball gets to him so quickly. See, bang, he's got the football right now. Now he's got a little room, there's a little bit of juke. You've got to use that outside as a defensive player when you're a cornerback and you've got a wide receiver like Price out there.
Back from the ankle injury in the spring, Peerless Price, they were very concerned about his future at the start of this season.
Out of the I formation, Manning will all of the lines. On the post, looking for David Martin, and it's incomplete. Martin, the freshman from Norfolk, Virginia, played at Northview High School there. Again, much like Jermaine White for Kentucky, they believe he's the heir apparent to big play receptions at Tennessee. And again, Manning a bit overthrown. Second down and 10 coming up with the ball at the 50-yard line.
Well, a lot of guys for Kentucky working hard up front. Manuar Stewart, number 55, they're relying a lot on him to get pressure today.
There's the quick hitch. And it's an option to pass for Copeland. And it's right there. Bryson. That, in essence, was a lateral thrown by Manning. And then Copeland, of course, a former quarterback. They love having ex-quarterbacks at wide receiver. That's always been a catchphrase for David Cutcliffe, their offensive coordinator.
Watch Copeland get rid of the pressure right there. He just dodges to the side and drills it in there. Should have been tackled. Should have been tackled for about a 3 or 4 yard loss. Kentucky cannot miss tackles today.
By the way, he did look like a former quarterback.
He certainly
getting
did.
Away from the pressure.
Kentucky, a little confused in getting their defensive alignment, calls a timeout with 44 seconds remaining here in the first quarter.
Well, there's so much pressure on Kentucky. They know their offense can move the football. They've got to stop Tennessee on defense. They've got to get some three and outs.
Well, Peyton Manning, you talk about getting the numbers up for him today. They're not only playing for the possibility of a title, but also for a Heisman Trophy. But he says you can't worry about that kind of thing.
Well, it really hasn't been too bad because as long as you don't, you know, get into it, as long as you just handle it yourself as a quarterback and try and play good team football, and you can't worry about something like that. You don't have a vote. There's no control over the situation. You might as well just have fun playing football. Try to play good football in order to help your team win, and let everything else take care of itself.
It's interesting, you know, you see Peyton Manning, Mike Major, the defensive coordinator of Kentucky, very concerned today that Tennessee would just line up a couple of tight ends and run at his defense. He thought they would be very effective, but it is something that we should mention. This is a quarterback that has an opportunity of giving your program a Heisman Trophy, much like a national title. That's something you can't put a price tag on, and they believe that his throwing the ball keeps Lewis from running it, and that can help Kentucky's play.
Oh, absolutely. That's exactly what Coach told us. He said, if we can just keep them in a passing game, we've got a chance. If they start just driving the ball down our throat, it's going to be a long day.
On the 29, first and 10, and another checkoff. Lewis, it's wide open for him. I think now you understand why Coach Major was so concerned about Jamal Lewis. Littleton Ward makes the tackle.
Well, Lewis has got everything that you want in a running back. You look at the stockiness of him. He's got tremendous quick feet. Finds the hole, draw a play, finds the hole to his left, just skirts through the hole. Now gets outside, and look at this. He's not running out of bounds. He just, boom, he makes one of those defensive corners. You're going to pay for it when you come up and try to tackle him.
He lines up to dot the I behind Bryson. First and 10 at the 17-yard line of Kentucky. Manning for McCullough. Touchdown,
knew it was going to be an offensive show, and we're getting shown offense. McCullough on just a quick post pattern off the line. You see Peyton Manning under no pressure. You see McCullough break clean right there. A little bit too much cushion there. The cushion is the defensive back, the distance that he allows the receiver to take off the line.
Hall's extra point gives Tennessee a 10-point lead with 32 seconds remaining here in the opening quarter.
And, Jim, it's an offensive dream and a defensive nightmare. Because watch McCullough when he comes off the line. The defensive back a little bit too much cushion. Finds him early. Bang, right there. You see the defensive back trying to come up right there. That's number 29, Tony Woods. He's got the cover closer than that.
That's a mistake by Woods. I mean, we touched on it with Coach Major yesterday. They really had a lot of confidence in Woods. He's just giving way too much room.
Can't give that much cushion. Cushion again, that defensive distance between the wide receivers. Because he'll eat you all day long. He'll just eat you alive.
McCullough, senior from Dayton, Ohio.
The only official website of the University of Kentucky.
Think they're going to get tired?
They may. They have to start checking the over-under numbers coming in for Rocky Top, too.
Tennessee band can go crazy with that. Now Manning up to 152 yards. A young man that's done so much for Tennessee.
You know, Philip Fulmer made the statement to us in our teleconference earlier this week. He said, you know, this is a program that owes Peyton Manning a great deal. So much that he has done for us. It's only right that he had this opportunity at a storybook finish to his career.
Absolutely, and I think that that's one of the reasons that they're throwing the football. I think they know they can run the football with great confidence anytime they want.
The kick is taken by
right now, Kentucky has got to come out and get some semblance of offense. You've got to take the pressure back off the defense. Couch has got to drive his team downfield. Al Mumme doesn't want to get him. And you see him right there talk to Tim Couch, saying, let's go crank it up, get some first downs, go back to our offense. And he's got over 102 yards. Boy, and you know, you go back to that interception. Yeah. That was a huge play because Kentucky was driving the length of the field in a good field position.
At that time, they could have taken a 14-3 lead. Instead, Tennessee gets about, it's a 14-point swing in this game.
On that controversial call on Terry Fair's interception.
Counts looking off one, maybe two receivers, and now decides to run. Stopped a yard behind the line of scrimmage, Noel.
Number nine, the first to get to him, the senior from Melrose High in Memphis, Tennessee.
Now, one of the things that Tennessee is doing is they're jamming the receivers and they're covering the short play. Kentucky's going to have to make a little bit of adjustment, maybe throw that ball a little longer.
We'll have time as the quarter comes to an end to talk about it. Tim Couch's club trails by 10, 17-7, before a record crowd here in the Commonwealth. Tennessee leads along with Chip Carter on the sidelines and Dave Rowe. I'm Tim Brando. Happy to have you with us as we look at the stats through one quarter. And the passing yards about where we thought they'd be, and the first downs dead even. The turnover, obviously the big one, that was a 14-point swing.
This is just an offensive back and forth, back and forth. A little interesting that Kentucky would have more yards rushing than Tennessee, but nothing astounding at that with those stats.
Homer remains in the backfield. He's now joined by number 35, A.J. Simon. Twin tight ends, Jimmy Haley, 37, Darren Clark, 88. Homer, nothing doing. So it'll be third down and long again. And the last thing that Al Mumme needs is another three and out.
He does not want his defense back on the field again.
Well, you talk about crowding the box. I can tell you that Tennessee is putting 8-9 men up in there. I think in this situation, if you're Tim Couch, you just throw that long. Maybe go to Yeast, hope that he can get open, just kind of get that one-on-one situation, because he can go up and get the football.
Across the middle, but very shy of a first down. That's Jimmy Robinson, and Kentucky will have to punt it away. And the Tennessee faithful that are on hand and in great number today.
Very pleased about the last couple of series in defending Tim Couch.
Jimmy Carter will be forced to punt it away with Terry Fair dropping back deep.
You know, it's interesting, as Chip told us about Jimmy Carter's punting, he actually punts out of bounds. They have no returns. They don't try to allow any returns. He actually punts about 35 to 40 yards. He's aiming at the sideline every time. Picks out a sideline, usually on the side that he kicks from the hash mark.
Heads to the left this time, sending fair to his right, and he'll have to let it go. That's a beautiful punt. It's a beautiful punt. Look at him. Tremendous job by Jimmy Carter. Let's go down to that other Carter. Chip.
Thanks a lot, Tim. I'm standing here with June Mummy, who has just successfully fought off cancer. The doctors now say it's in remission, and that's nice to hear.
Oh, it's the best news that, you know, I could possibly hear.
Now you're out there getting a check, and you've taken your fight and actually gone public with it, and you're lending your support to a lot of people who need it, obviously.
Oh, I want to help people understand cancer better, help educate them, and get more involved with fundraising.
All right, thanks a lot, June.
All right.
Boy, she is inspirational, Chip, to be sure. My sister's been going through breast cancer, and it is tough. Up ahead for a couple of yards is Jamal Lewis. And, you know, you go back to Hal Mummy when he was up for this job. In fact, when he was first contacted by C.M. Newton and began negotiations, that's when his wife was diagnosed.
Yeah, he had a number one team in the nation. He had Kentucky calling, and he had a tremendous family concern. So a lot of pressure on that young man.
All of that while he was at Valdosta State just a season ago. My, how things have changed in a year's time. Second and six. Pattern is incomplete. Careless Price, the intended receiver.
And there you see one of those left passes. You see Peyton Manning thrown across his body. Wasn't even close. That's what Kentucky's trying to hope they can do.
Crowd rises to attention now as they anticipate a third down.
Oh, boy. Look at that score. Duke 14 to nothing over North Carolina. That's a shocker.
Brett Goldsmith trying to pull one off against Mack Brown's team. Michigan now up 13.
Huge down here, Tim. Third down. Eight to go.
Manning decides to tuck it. First down, Tennessee.
Well, this is going to be close. Where they mark it? Where did his knee go down? He looked as if he had to make about the 24-yard line.
Oh, he got it.
Yeah. Not even a measurement, they say, right away. He made it. Heads up play that time. Kentucky that time, they loop to the outside trying to get pressure right there. You see him coming around right there, loop to the outside, and Manning saw the hole and scampers up for the first down marker.
Got away from David Ginn, 44, the senior from Cincinnati, and Peyton can get it done on the ground as well.
You know what I like about Peyton Manning? The competitive spirit that he's got.
Lewis. Power to go along with his speed. Gordon Crowe made the stop, number 95.
Well, they got big men up front. They got great blockers. Bryson, of course, leads Lewis a lot of times on the blocks, and they're controlling that line of scrimmage. You're going to see it right here. Big man on big man. Good block to the outside. Now, just come outside. He looks back for that hole, doesn't see it. Lewis just puts that. And he's got great feet. You see how quick his feet are? And he never puts his head down when he gets hit. Puts that shoulder in there, but doesn't put his head down.
Second and nine. Him up. A senior from Louisville's Ballard High, transferred over from Indiana State, Bob Holmberg.
If there's one player that's got to play big on the run, it's Bob Holmberg, number 51. You see him in the middle of your screen, take on the guard now, slide, slide, stay up big in there, hold on, and wait for help.
Again, the crowd trying to become a factor, third down and eight. He's got it. Shy of the first down.
Well, that's a good open field tackle to keep him short of that first down. All depends where the mark's going to be. That's Tremaine Martin, number 26, the strong safety.
When Copeland broke for the ball, he had the first down. But then Martin forced him in. And I think he's shy by about
ball
the length of the football.
This comes up your famous right or left foot mark. Boop. That's a left one, isn't it?
That's right. You know, and you'll never get an official to agree with that.
We'll never get an official to agree with that.
Coach Major realizes his team now has kept them fourth and less than a yard.
And you know what's interesting? Tennessee playing safe in this situation. I believe they're going to punt it away. But if I'm them,
I see Manning still in the game.
Yeah, if I got a running back like Jamal Lewis, I go for it.
Unlike Kentucky, Fulmer's team, second fewest fourth down attempts this year in the SEC.
Manning's feet went out from under him.
Here comes the left to right foot mark.
Oh, wow.
Well, the ball did go in front of Peyton, and it appears as if they are giving him enough.
He got over the line.
I thought his feet slipped out because he went right down right away. That was close.
Yeah, he got the first down, though.
Well, because the ball,
they're going to measure, but I believe he did get it.
Well, see, that's a wet part of the field. It's on the hash mark. And I thought Manning, when he went to do the quarterback sneak, it looked as if his feet, or maybe he was diving. But it looked awfully close. Oh, boy. Just by a couple inches.
By the nose of the football.
See how watch Manning. See, watch his position. See right there? He just goes right straight down. You don't really see him slip in that, puddle there. But again, it didn't look as if he got, like, really a jump in there.
First and 10. Just shy of the 35-yard line. Al Mummy said he did not want his defense out there for more than 60 snaps today. Well, this kind of drive can wear your defense down. And you start giving it to this fella, and they'll play power football and get ahead for 3 or 4 yards. Jeff Snediger, number 17, in to make the tackle.
Well, there's so much pressure on the corners in a defense like this because Kentucky knows they've got to keep a lot of people in the middle. They've got to have help, so they're creeping up the strong safety and the free safety up into the line. They're only about five yards off the line of scrimmage, and that means that the corners are all by themselves. You see Snediger, he's the outside backer, number 17. Everybody's trying to get in the middle to stop Lewis.
Second down and 7. This is the 27th snap the Kentucky defense has played today. Out pattern complete to Marcus Nash. That's a first down up at the 48-yard line. So already Tennessee with more than 27 snaps, and we still have 9.5 minutes remaining in the first half. This does not bode well for Kentucky. Phillip Fulmer's got just the kind of drive he needs to wear Kentucky down.
Well, and what Phillip Fulmer is starting to do, you see the change a little bit. What they're doing is they're using the running back. And that first two drives, they ran 12 or 13 plays. 11 of them were passes. Now all of a sudden you have that little mix using that fullback a little bit more.
Lewis, he'll wear you down inside the 40 to the 36-yard line. You know, interestingly, if you're looking at it from a stat fact and a stat point of view, Manning gets his 100-plus yards in the first quarter, and now Lewis on his way to 100 in the second.
Absolutely. Big man up the middle. Jermaine Martin in there, number 26, missed a little tackle there. They bring him down, but not before he rumbles upfield.
There you see the rushing improvement since Jamal Lewis. And as Peyton Manning told me, we are now Tennessee the way Tennessee ought to be. Both run and pass ratio in check, near 50-50.
Manning saw the sneak up front.
For the fade, incomplete. McCullough, the intended receiver.
Boy, that was close to being timeout. You saw the clock in there. I think that's what the fans are reacting to. They wanted to see the penalty.
Fans believe the Heisman front runner got away with one.
Yeah, they certainly did. That time clock in there. But Manning's just taking control of this football game. He's reading the defense quickly. Now, Kentucky didn't have enough people on the field. They've got to call a timeout.
That's two times now. Damage control has been taken for timeouts where Kentucky's defense is concerned. They're on their heels, and Manning's got them there. We'll be back. And during the timeout, Al Mummy got to Al Ford and several others caught their ear about what he felt should have been a clock violation. 25-second clock had expired prior to that last fade pattern thrown by Manning.
Well, they escaped, though, on it. It was an incomplete pass. There you see their clock resets there. And Kentucky has no timeouts left for the rest of this half.
And they've had to use them on defense.
Exactly.
Four wide receivers for Manning on second and 10.
Pass all the way because you see all the linemen in their upstance. Manning trying to bring his fullback up to pick up the blitz.
Here it comes. Snedeker's got him.
The question has been posed, why no Jamal Lewis early in the year? He had an off-the-field problem that's been well documented. The other problem, not picking up the blitz.
Well, you see him bring Jamal Lewis up on the line. See him step up in there? He knows it's a blitz. There comes the blitz. He can't get away from the pressure. Lewis slides to the outside, and Snedeker gets him. That's his third sack of the year for Jeff Snedeker.
Third down, 24, at the Tennessee 48.
See, Manning's having problems having people hear him now. They don't hit you any better than that.
Willie Gary had it right in his mitts. Hit the shoulder pad.
Looked as if the receiver fell down, and that ball hit Willie Gary right in the shoulder. I mean, it's right in the pocket. Watch to the left or to the right of your screen. Look at this. He's got it right. Bang. Bounces right off. That's why you want to catch the football away from your body.
Some would say that's why you're a defensive back. Pass was intended for Nash. Craig East is back deep. Chris Hogue. High and short. Fair catch called for by East at the 13-yard line. 7:39 remaining in the opening half. Tennessee's lead at 10. Back after a word from your local SEC station. A sellout crowd here at Commonwealth Stadium in Lexington, Kentucky. The battle for the beer barrel. 17-7, Tennessee with the lead. Look at that. Since the controversial interception by Terry Fair, Kentucky's been throttled. 12 yards and two punts. They had 150 prior to that pick.
Oh, it was huge because it really rattled Jim Couch.
Pressure. Keo Sanford on the quick curl. Look out. Look out. Now the sprinter speed. Goodrich is after him. Touchdown! By the way, great decision by the officials. No flag. He dove into the end zone.
Well, you see the missed tackle there by number 46, Raynaud Thompson, and now it's just a foot race into the end zone. Now, he's going to get hit on about the 5-yard line, and you're going to see him break the plane. Look at this. Get those feet up, and he just dives to break the plane.
By rule, that could have been a celebration penalty.
Well.
But better judgment by the officials. Yeah. With a no call, he had been hit, he felt pressure, and then dove in for six.
Boy, does that help your passing yardage. We do have a player down on about the 5-yard line. I believe it's a Tennessee player that's down on the field over there.
May have been Goodrich who was stretching to get him.
Yeah, he may have gotten kicked in the face because he dove for him, and a lot of times you'll catch an inadvertent foot kick you in the face. And I think that's what happened to Dwayne Goodrich.
And again, this is that play.
Watch right there. You see him? Watch him get kicked in the face right there? What a huge play there by Kentucky.
And that has been the play where the tackles come out in front, sprint to the end, and then lay a few blocks for a guy like Sanford or East.
Exactly. It's an underneath screen. Now, what they do is they throw the screen, and the big tackles, the offensive linemen, slide along. And what Sanford has to do is he has to pick up those blocks. When he gets back just about to the middle of the field, he breaks up field.
12 yards and two punts since the interception. It all changes. 88 yards here. Watch Tim Couch as he watches this play as Sanford sets sail.
You see Sanford come back against the grain there, but Tim Couch gets the best view of this play. He has to love it at the tail end. Now he knows it's just a foot race. And for Tim Couch, this is a lot of yards passing. Hey, how about Couch? How about Couch down there? He throws a block on Torrey Noel. slam catch. He was about 30 yards downfield.
17-14, how quickly it can change, and the inspirational leader happens to be your best player.
Well, you know what? You mentioned what they had gotten, the yardage that they had gotten after that interception, and it rattled Tim Couch. But he got his composure back. Hal Mumme talks to him on the sideline a lot, and he got it right back together, and they throw a strike. Don't sit down if you're at home. That's what they're saying right now. Don't sit down at home. This is a scoring battle.
Samuel kicks it away. Levine from his three. Flag comes down at the 15-yard line as he's hit. Ryan Murphy there to get him.
Well, you have to think this is a penalty against the defense covering maybe the face mask or something along that line. That's what the, if you're Tennessee, you're hoping for, a face mask to get that ball out past the 20-yard line.
Probably a non-flagrant variety.
An incidental face mask against the defense, 5 yards, first down.
Tennessee now with a three-point lead, 17-14. The good news about this Kentucky offense is it's out of the doldrums. The bad news, he wanted longer drives today. Now his defense has to go back on the field after surrendering yet another long drive a few moments ago.
But it's a much spirited defense right now. They've got a lot of enthusiasm, a lot of people behind them. They're trying to see if they can answer the call.
Quick hits. Peerless Price stopped in his tracks by Littleton Ward.
And, Tim, anytime you're undersized, and that's what Kentucky is in this football game, especially on their defensive line, you have to play with emotion. I'm going to tell you, there's a lot of passing yards today. Look at this.
Single game passing yards. Couch already has 196 today. Manning has 173. So Peyton and Couch are perhaps going after single game records before this one is over. Second down and six. Play by Woods and Gary. Both of them went for the pick and not the tackle, and Nash could have set sail.
Well, Woods is their best cover man. You see him on the outside. What he does, though, they come up and they try to catch it. He tries to break the ball up, and a lot of times Woods, he's their best cover man, and a lot of times he will take a chance and make a mistake. You can't do that against Kentucky, because, I mean, against Tennessee, because they'll burn you.
Yeah, Nash will. That's for sure. The 34, first down 10. Play fake. Manning looking, has his man. Marcus Nash. Will he burn you? You betcha.
You talk about him burning you, this is what happens. And they love the crossing pattern. Throws to the right, off a little bit off that back foot. Watch his plant. Coming to the inside, too much cushion. You can't give him that much room. Can't give him that much time. This is the results when you do. And Nash just goes to the afterburners.
His 11th touchdown of the season, his second of the day. And you're right. I mean, Woods obviously giving way too much room. Something that Mike Major, his defensive coordinator, just did not anticipate. 5:47 remaining in the half. Would you say the air raid is on? I would. That's the thunder and lightning of Kentucky and Tennessee. The air raid is on, 24-14 between the two schools, 467 yards in the air.
Wow.
Between Manning and Tim Couch, and Jeff Hall prepares to kick it away for the Volunteers. Hey, we still have 5:47 remaining in the second quarter. And you know, see Craig East dropping back deep. He's joined by Derek Homer for Kentucky as we anticipate this kick from Hall.
Well, Tim, you know, you talk about big games and lots of offense. I'll never forget a game, TCU against Houston, when Houston had that run and shoot.
Klingler, Klingler era?
Exactly. There was over 1,000 yards of offense. I want to say it was like 1,040, 60, something like that. I'll never forget the game.
We could get that today.
We could certainly get that. That's incredible. What a half of football.
Wonder how John Ward called that touchdown. Again, the Scott kick. Fair catch called for. John Ward, legendary voice of the Tennessee Volunteers. He's had to say, give him six many times. There you see him along with Bill Anderson together for 30 years. Here's his call of the TD.
Manning off play action again. He's going to go downfield across the middle. Pull down at the 45, to the 40, to the 35, 30, 25, 20, 15, 10, 5. Give it to him. Touchdown!
Tennessee. He will say, touchdown, Tennessee. Touchdown, Big Orange. And give him six.
Yeah, absolutely.
The delay handoff to Homer up to the 30-yard line. I tell a story about John Ward. We were doing a Mississippi State game the same day Georgia was playing Tennessee. And there are a couple of 50,000-watt stations in the southeast where you can hear Bill Anderson with him. But both John Ward and Larry Munson calling the same game.
Oh, boy.
I could literally go from frequency to frequency on WLAC and WSB and hear both of them. You talk about it, fun.
I bet you it was. Hunker down.
They're so much bigger than we are.
Venom.
Homer, it's wide open. Look out. Mr. Kentucky football with Bear on his hip. Down he goes inside the 10.
Boy, what a half a football, a 64-yard run. Watch this, burst up the middle, gets a great hole up front. Webster Watts opens up in the middle, and watch Homer just turn on the burners right here. Now, he's running an out. He's running outrunning Terry Fair there, who's got outstanding speed. That's the only thing kept him from a touchdown.
Well, by the way, it's not just about Manning and Couch. It's about Jamal Lewis and Derek Homer.
Absolutely.
Inside the 20, that's how efficient they've been. Mostly touchdowns. A.J. White could not make the corner. That's a tremendous run support play by Corey Gaines, the free safety, coming up to make the stop, number 30 in orange.
Well, Corey Gaines is the free safety, and he keys on him right here. He just keys on Anthony White, number 32. You see him just slide to the outside, wrap that hands up, bring him down. That's an excellent play.
Second and six.
Kentucky scores down here. They score via the pass.
Second and goal at the 6-yard line. Flags down and from the looks of.
Before the ball was snapped, movement by the offense. 5 yards, still second down.
Now, the body lean of Tim Couch could tell you that.
Well, I thought on that play, Derek Homer started off a little bit fast. He was trying to get a block.
But Tennessee, no penalties in this game. Just what Philip Fulmer needs from his club. No mistakes when you're taking on a team like this that's so dangerous. And you know, Kentucky is a far more dangerous team with this offense when they play at home.
Well, and this gives Tim Couch a little bit more operating room as you're out a little bit farther out past the 10-yard line.
Out of the shotgun, four wide receivers. Couch over the middle, Robinson to the 3-yard line.
Number 9, Jimmy Robinson.
Jimmy Robinson stopped by Sean Johnson.
Boy,
reserve
Johnson,
middle linebacker.
Watch Johnson just stick him right here. Coming across the middle, you're in no man's land. Bang, right there. I think Couch in this situation, a lot of times he loves to go to that fade. What's amazing is we haven't seen Yeast. I can't remember.
He's not caught a pass today. Couch is up to 204 yards in the air. Third down and goal at the 3.
Touchdown! again, front handoff right there. You see the big blocks there. 70's Comstock. 57 is Watts. And they just burst up the middle. And watch Tim Couch coming to the side. Look at this. You think he's not excited? I know they tried to downplay Peyton Manning and Tim Couch. And I know what he said, but I know the heart of an athlete. I can promise you that Peyton Manning was excited, as was Tim Couch.
White, by the way, made a tremendous cut on that play. And this is a young man that early in this season, with his misdirection and 4.6 speed, was really a difference maker for this team. A young man that had some problems in his freshman year, was suspended from play, and has now gotten new life with Hal Mumme as his head coach.
I've seen Earl Anderson. He keeps on sharpening pencils over there. Our stats man is having a day today. Unbelievable. You talk about offense. You like offense? It's not my favorite kind of game, but I love watching the offense just go up and down the field.
Samuel will kick it away.
We got 45 points in the first half. We still have almost 3 minutes left.
Samuel boots this one deep. Mark Levine at the goal line. In trouble again at the 10. Jeff Zerker, number 49, reserve strong safety down there to make the stop.
Huge play this time. Peyton Manning knows that he's deep in trouble now. He's got to get his offense going. You talk about total yards. Look at this. 641 yards offense. Incredible.
Very quick addition by Dave Rowe, whom, by the way, I should mention was a liberal arts major at Penn State.
Thank you. Thank you. What a game of football. You got to love it. Nobody in Kentucky has sat down.
Quick hitch. Copeland. Nowhere. He got absolutely nothing. Snedeker right there with him, number 17.
Boy, Snedeker had to come a long way. He was in his backer spot when he came off the ball. This is his ball all the way. You'll see him left your screen. Now, once the ball's played, look how far Snedeker's got to come. He puts that hand on him, and he pulls him down. Now, if you're Kentucky, you've got to think about timeouts in this situation. You don't want to call it too quick. You don't want to allow the offense to drive and get a first down.
Bob Holmberg just checked out. Injured his wrist, it appeared. His left wrist. So he's out of there. Second and 10. Looking long and thrown incomplete. Well over the head of Jermaine Copeland.
Coach says, watch me catch that ball. Incomplete. Well, again, that stops the clock. Minute 56 left. You can see the concern on Philip Fulmer's situation. He does not want to give this football back to Kentucky before halftime.
Third down and 10.
Boy, the noise is going to be incredible for Peyton Manning.
Copeland, not this time. Tremaine Martin wraps him up.
Now you remember they have no timeouts. They can't call timeout in this situation.
Listen to this crowd.
You want to give him the short one on this. It's a crossing pattern from left to right. Now, come up and make the tackle. Hold him short of that first down. Get the football back for Tim Couch and company.
Chris Hogue to boot it. Should get it off around his five. East, who hasn't touched it on offense, will touch it on special teams. And down immediately. A huge play met immediately by Jeremy Fitzgerald. Down there to make the stop.
Well, Tim, think about the field position that Tim Couch has. 46-yard line. He's in the middle of the field. Great field position, but again, it's compounded by no timeouts.
Jared Hayden down there to make the first contact for Tennessee.
Boy, when's the last time Craig Yeast has not had a catch in the first half of a football game? He had 69 in this first half, in this so far this season. He has none today.
A.J. Simon back in the backfield. Homer again. Why not? They have found a soft spot between the tackles of that Tennessee defense, and both Homer and Anthony White have been successful of late running the football without any time. timeouts and the clock ticking under a minute left.
Well, 58 seconds as we watch the clock tick down and look at concern on John Chavis' face. 58 seconds is a long time for Tim Couch and company.
White, not much room.
Timeouts again. They can't stop the clock. They've got to hurry.
That's a debatable call given the time and no timeouts remaining.
Well, they're running players in and out. Boy, what a waste of time, though.
Yeah, very much.
Clock ticking down. Go to Yeast.
Under 30 seconds left.
Couch on the fade for Yeast.
His first reception today. His 70th reception to lead the Southeastern Conference, and Coach Rowe makes the call.
One-on-one, I'm going to go to Yeast if I'm Tim Couch, and that's exactly what he does. Throws it up just a perfect fade. Then you see Yeast just look the football in. We have an injured player on that play. Phil Duff went to the sideline, number 50. He was hurt on the rush, but right now it's Yeast time. That was just amazing. 69 receptions so far. That was his first one today.
From the 18.
Flag down. As Couch decided to tuck it.
Now that stops the clock. Yeah. If it's an offensive, if it's defense offsides, it's a free five yards.
Well, you're right. It does help them because it stops the clock.
But they're pointing back to Kentucky.
Illegal formation. 5 yard penalty, still second down.
But it does help. It stops the clock.
Yes, certainly does. That would have been crucial right there. With 14 seconds left, you can hardly get off another play. If you're Tim Couch, you've got to throw the football downfield.
Clock is moving.
I'd spike the ball and kick a field goal, maybe.
That's what Mummy wanted. He did not get it. The clock will wind down. A mistake by Kentucky offensively. Hal Mummy could not get word to his offensive football team to spike the football. A huge error, and you see Mummy pointing him at himself saying, my bad, my mistake. That one's on me. Chip Carter is downstairs with Hal Mummy.
Coach, you scored right there late, 24-21. Obviously, you wanted to stop the clock and kick the field goal, but you got to feel pretty good about this first half.
Yeah, it wasn't Tim's fault. It was mine. We thought we had about three more seconds. We thought we'd make that first down and then clock it and be able to get it. So it's my bad. It wasn't his.
It's a shootout, but it's the kind of game you wanted to see actually coming in instead of Tennessee running the football. This gives you a good chance to win.
I'm real proud of our guys. They're playing hard.
Thanks, Coach. Tim, we'll be back with more. 24-21. It is a wild one here in Lexington. We'll be back after these local messages. All right, the score right now at the Commonwealth Stadium, Tennessee 24, Kentucky 21, and a record crowd watching this one today. In fact, they had to bring in extra seats on the four corners of the stadium. They've got about 2,000 total extra seats. This is a sellout crowd. In fact, they've set a record for season tickets so far here this year. And let's go back upstairs, and I think Tim and David finally had a chance to catch your breath. Have you guys?
Well, let me say this to you, Chip. For starters, normally at halftime you have to go someplace.
Yeah.
Tougher to get back. Because, and let me tell you, you could miss three scores if you left this game during play, correct?
Absolutely incredible. And, you know, for Kentucky, this is amazing. The atmosphere, as you said, there must be 100 to 200 extra people here this week. The whole press box is just as crowded as you can possibly be, and just amazing football atmosphere.
I don't know, Dave, that I've ever seen a better offensive half of football.
Or a worse defensive.
Well, I mean, let's face it. These are two offenses that are going to make your defense look bad hurriedly because you've got to change so much of your defensive philosophy because of the styles of play.
Well, we talked about that in the opening. I told you that you cannot stop them. All you can do is try to slow them down. And for Kentucky, this is the kind of game they want. Back, forth, back, forth. This is the kind of game they're going to stay in. But again, what a first half. If you like highlights, fans, you're going to love them.
Take a look.
Well, first of all, it starts off the Couch. Throws this little out pass to Homer way out here in the flat. And watch what Homer does with it. He runs it in for a score. Great block there downfield. But Homer starts off the highlight. Then it's Tennessee's field goal, 50 yards. Quite a first half field goal. Longest field goal of the year for Hall.
Then it was Marcus Nash on the receiving end a couple of times. Here's the first one.
Boy, and it's to Nash on just an outstanding catch and run down the sideline. Manning comes right on the next play. He's going to hit McCullough on a little crossing pattern, and the scoring goes on and on.
Then, after Kentucky had been throttled, that little play, the bread and butter to Keo Sanford, 88 yards later, Kentucky's back in it.
And watch Couch come in here and get a block. Watch this right there. You're going to see number two, Blue, is going to get a block right there. You see Couch? He's 40 yards downfield. But it's not over yet because it's Nash time. Little crossing pattern, come to the post, too much of cushion, 64 yards for a touchdown.
Tony Woods is going to have a much better second half if Kentucky's to have an opportunity at an upset.
And this is an interesting last highlight. It's just a handoff, a great blocking up there by the offensive line of Kentucky.
And you look at our Jefferson Pilot Insurance halftime stats, and again, it suggests just how much of a showcase offensively it's been. We may be on our way to a record number for a Division I A game, if not the SEC.
Well, what's this maybe? We got 694 yards of offense in the first half. You love offense? You love this kind of game.
We have come to the most important time of our halftime show, and that would be Rose Rewind.
Well, I'm out of breath, but let's go try and see what we can do.
I mean, let's face it. Rose Rewind, that would take a while in today's game.
Well, first of all, for Tennessee, they've got to pound the football. Give it to Lewis. He only has 40 yards and rushing. And then Nasham. Keep on going out there to Nash. He has just been all the first half offense for Tennessee. For Kentucky, keep the defense fresh. Try to keep them off the field and be a homer. And that doesn't mean the hometown crowd. That means Derek Homer, their great running back.
Again, though, we have to look at overall defensive snaps. I will remind everyone that LSU trailed this Kentucky team at home 21-20, then buried Kentucky in the second half. And we've seen in the games that we've had earlier this year, both with South Carolina and Mississippi State, two games where Kentucky really had control. They grew tired in the second half, particularly from a defensive perspective. If you play too many snaps, Tennessee can wear you down.
Well, what happens is you play this game with emotion, and Kentucky has had all kinds of emotion. Now you go in at halftime, your players are tired. How many snaps can they be effective in the second half? That's a huge question that's going to be answered. But they're playing this game with a tremendous crowd, tremendous emotion, and an outstanding quarterback who says, just keep on giving me the ball.
You know, if you think about it, coming into this game, no one felt that they could be as successful as they were if they couldn't get anything out of Craig East, and they've been very successful. Let's go downstairs to Chip Carter, who's got Philip Fulmer.
Coach, you're in an offensive shootout. Both quarterbacks have nearly 250 yards throwing the football in the first half.
We expected that. You know, that's not different. Anytime you come to Kentucky, it's a tough football game. They're playing hard. We're playing hard. This team that makes the fewest mistakes will win this football game.
Got to try and run it a little bit more in the second half and use Jamal a little bit.
We got to get their safeties out of there. They're playing a lot of man-to-man coverage, a lot of people close to the line. They paid for it. We do need to run the football better, too.
Thanks a lot, Coach. Tim?
112 Division I-A coaches in America today. Some of them may be losing their jobs, but none of them have quite the pressure that's on the shoulders of Philip Fulmer as he brings his Volunteers out for the second half. Perfect day for offensive football here in Lexington, Kentucky. A record crowd. They will eclipse 60,000, they feel, today with the extra seating that's been brought in. Almost 2,000 extra seats, bleachers brought in there. You see them in the corners of the end zone here at Commonwealth Stadium. A magnificent facility. Tim Couch, a magnificent quarterback. And I'm sure he'll be reliving the last seconds of that first half when, in fact, he could have taken some heat off of his coach by simply spiking the football. He chose not to. And, of course, Peyton Manning delivering and then some in his quest not only for a Tennessee title but a Heisman Trophy.
Well, you talk about possessions and what they've done with the football. It's incredible. Both teams just up and down the field, scoring at will, yardage. I mean, it's just been an amazing football game. You see him on the sideline. You said magnificent to describe Couch. Now, what adjective are you going to describe Peyton Manning with?
You run out of superlatives.
Exactly right.
You really do. Samuel kicks it away. Cedric Wilson inside his 10. Now angling for the sideline. Cedric Wilson.
out to the 35-yard line. A tremendous run by the young man. And it's a quality field position for the Volunteers as they open up. And, of course, they really haven't needed quality field position to be productive.
Well, look at the plays and look at the results. 7 and a field goal, 6 and a touchdown. They just need to have the football. Just give me some more possession. That's what Philip Fulmer and Peyton Manning are saying.
That's amazing. The difference is in the booth. I saw both athletic directors. I have to tell you about that in just a moment.
Right off, he starts off with an audible on the line.
Lewis dots the I and gets it. Ahead for 4 yards. Pretty good play by Tremaine Martin, the strong safety, meeting head-on against Jamal Lewis. I ran into C.M. Newton, and he was all smiles.
Oh, he certainly was.
I ran into Doug Dickey, and he was rather pensive. I mean, this is not the kind of game that Coach Dickey, as a former football coach, loves seeing either, because offense is moving up and down the field. Not something a former coach loves watching, but entertaining to be sure for the fans here.
Audible along the line. He checks about 70% of the time. He calls the play on the line of scrimmage.
Much as does Couch. Nash at midfield. That's a first down in the arms of Eric Kelly, number 20.
And, Tim, you know, if there's one stat that kind of sticks out to me, it's the one that we just showed, that graphic with Jamal Lewis's rushing yards. Only 50 yards today. Now, Nash is going to get his yards. Look at that, 155 yards as we see him on this little curling pattern. Just curl the outside, throw the ball to him. He comes down, but he's a big-time wide receiver.
And, again, Manning throwing to his right side. That's his favorite side, according to Mike Major, the defensive coordinator of Kentucky. Now he swings it out to Lewis. They flood the zone, and no one's there. Jamal Lewis. Touchdown.
Peyton Manning, you cannot blitz him. If you blitz him, you're going to die, because he just finds Lewis out in the flat, just dumps the ball over top. But what a block downfield by Fearless Price. Look at this. He reads the blitz, throws it to him. Now watch Price, 37. He's got the block right there. Look at this. 5 yards, 10 yards, 15 yards. Into the field for touchdown.
He goes from potential receiver to blocker.
Oh, look at that seat.
They didn't bring those in, did they? Those just happened to be there.
Those were unoccupied.
Hall with the extra point.
The kick is good.
92 seconds deep into the third quarter, and the Volunteers go 65 yards. The last 50, courtesy Manning. He may be number one. He's got a shot to be sure.
Tim, two things make this play work. First of all, the clear out by the two outside wide receivers. Watch them come inside. You see that there's Copeland, number 6, coming inside. And you see they just flood inside. Now, just bring Lewis out there, and he's off to the race. This is just a foot race. Nobody's going to catch him down the sideline. Again, we talked about the good block by Fearless Price. Downfield right there. You see the tail end of it. Result, a lot of yards for Peyton Manning's passing.
Records being broken for both teams in one half, and Manning going after more in the opening series of the second half. But the lead, a lead of 10 is nothing. You're going to need probably a 17 to 20 point lead to feel safe in this game.
Safe. The only safe lead is when the gun goes off and there's zeros on the clock.
Greg East. Got a lot of speed. Very dangerous. Looking for an extra seam. Gets it beyond the 25. To the 26-yard line as we look at the possessions for Kentucky, and their offensive productivity stunted after that debatable interception, and a lot of people will be talking about that in the aftermath of this game if the Big Blue loses a close game.
But that last one is the one that sticks in my mind. When they got all the way down, they were down to about the 18-19-yard line. They had a chance for at least a field goal to tie this football game up. They didn't have the timeouts, Tim, didn't spike the ball, and it ran out on downs.
And they had to call them because of their defensive adjustments that they were having to make in the first half, not with their offense. Couch finds East. Every time he touches it, you believe he can break one. Raynock Thompson, 46, grabs him at the shoelaces.
Well, you have to think of your Tim Couch as you see 14 for 21, 256 yards. But if you're Tim Couch, you've got to think, go to Yeast.
find him out there. Looks off wide receivers well. Look at him scanning the field. See his head motion? A little bit of pressure at the tail end. There's the pass to Yeast. And I think if you were in that Kentucky locker room at halftime, they said, hey, Craig Yeast has got one catch. That's not normal.
Both Goodrich and Duff, who were injured in the first half, are in the second. Ball popped free, but Kentucky on top of it. Number 70, Chris Comstock, the right tackle, junior from Apopka, Florida, has been one of Guy Morris's best offensive linemen. Morris, the offensive line coach, who was at Mississippi State a season ago, joined up with Hal Mumme upon Mumme's assignment here in Kentucky.
Well, that was a good hit right in the middle. That was just a super, just stick right in the middle. That's exactly what you want to do. Get up in there. I think that was Ray Knock Thompson, number 46, who got that hit in the middle. Pop that ball free.
Second down and 14. Couch running out of time. Now steps up, finds Sanford. That's a first down. His ability to elude and his resourcefulness in the pocket, and then the ability to step up. I think that's what separates Couch from others.
It's called pocket awareness. It's knowing where the pressure is. He knows Jonathan Brown is to his right. He's number 91 for Tennessee. You see the pressure now. Watch. Step up. He doesn't want to run with the football. Flatten out. Find your receiver. And you see how he always looks downfield. Great quarterbacks don't take their eyes off their wide receivers downfield. A lot of hype about who's the best quarterbacks in the nation. Fans are seeing them today. These are the two best quarterbacks in the nation.
White,
without a doubt,
gets ahead a couple of yards. Torrey Noel, his seventh tackle of the afternoon.
Now, if you're Tim Couch and company, you're almost down in four down territory. So you've got to keep a drive going in here. Second down, 8 yards. You've been real successful with those underneath passes. You've just made those adjustments at halftime. Keep going to what's working. If you're Tennessee on the other side of the ball, you may take away those little short ones and give the deep ones, hoping that Couch doesn't have time to look downfield.
Leonard Little has now moved to defensive end. They've got him on the line where he's more effective up at the top of your screen. Couch out to the left to White. White breaks one tackle inside the 30-yard line. Missed tackle by Raynock Thompson, allowing White another 10 yards.
And you know, as Raynock Thompson got down, he came down on his shoulder. You see the mud on the right shoulder? You see him getting up, putting that hand on his hip? He may have gotten a hip pointer on that. Right hip on that time, because when he came hard down on his hip. And one of the other players said, hey, come over here, we have an injury. See if Couch doesn't go right back against Raynock Thompson.
Little again. On the line of scrimmage, up at the top, playing defensive end. They now put Sean Johnson in at middle linebacker, number 35. Homer running right at Johnson to about the 25-yard line. Darwin Walker, number 58, making the tackle.
Well, they're definitely in four-down territory right now for Tim Couch and company. And that's interesting as we talked to Hal Mumme yesterday. He said, I'd almost rather go for it. Fourth and short, I'd rather go for it because that's just the same as a turnover to me. It's another possession that keeps the drive alive.
And he and Tommy Tuberville have been amazing at their efficiency in fourth down. Imagine this. Tuberville at Ole Miss is 11 out of 14 this year converting fourth down. Second down and 6. Lead handoff to Homer again. Tennessee would have none of it this time as Sean Johnson, the sophomore from Louisville, Kentucky. Big game for him, you would have to believe. From Ballard High School at nearby Louisville. Tore his, he's hoping for an opportunity to take over for Leonard Little in the middle as Little moves to defensive end.
Well, that's an interesting move by Tennessee. They know they have to get pressure on the quarterback, so they move Johnson into middle linebacker. They're going to give away experience in the middle, trying to get that pressure from Leonard Little.
Third down and 5. In trouble. Finds Sanford again. Keo cannot get away from Noel and Little as they run him down 3 yards shy of a first down.
Now you come up with that fourth down situation. Fourth down about 2 or 3. Do you want to try a field goal in this situation? Seth Hansen, the field goal kicker for Kentucky, is not a good distance kicker. He hasn't kicked a lot of kicks. Only 6 of them. I think you go for it.
Look at that. Now, in the 15 times that they have been unsuccessful, the opposition has only come back and scored three times. That's a very interesting point. When you look at the go-for-it mentality, it has not cost money, even when they've been unsuccessful.
Watch out for Yeast. He's got to come on that crossing pattern. I can just see it in his eyes. Did he make the first down?
Forward progress.
Look at the mark. 19-yard line. They had to make the 20, Tim.
Yeah, he got a good mark. And forward progress did net him the 20-yard line. And he moved the chain.
And you know what Tennessee wanted? They all pointed at the left tackle, Jonas Meaney. They all thought that he jumped. Watch right here. Look on the left of your screen right here. You're going to see out to the flat. Look at Couch. Move around. Great pocket. Now, get the first down. All he had to do right there, you see he had gone past the 20-yard line inside. He gets a good mark. That's a first down. And they convert another one, Tim.
10th play of the drive. Homer. Look at the cutback ability he has. Now, he gets 3 yards on his own. He's missed a block that could have propelled that play.
I'll tell you one thing. You can't give up on a block if you're a wide receiver, and that's what Yeast does on this. See him in the bottom of your screen? Watch this. He just stops right there. He lets him off. You got to keep on driving those feet because you let him off, and they're going to come up and tackle you short.
Terry Fair comes up to make the play, and you're right. Yeast became a spectator in the middle of his block.
Yeah, you got to stay with him because you never know what that back is going to do.
Second and seven at the Volunteers, 17.
Afraid to take a hit.
He's asking his receiver, come back to me. Yeah.
That's exactly what you do. When your quarterback's in trouble, you come back to him. Don't keep on running your pattern away.
He was looking for Lance Mickelson, number 21.
You see Leonard Little got a little bit of pressure on the tail end of that play. But again, look at Couch. Give that shoulder. Just put that shoulder down. He's not afraid to take a hit. He's a big guy. Now look at Mickelson out in the end zone right there. You see him in the end zone? He's saying, come back to me. Boy, he was open right there.
All right, Jonathan Brown was giving chase as well. Third down. We'll call it 10 after the loss. Couch, the slant. Complete. Right to Robinson, but again, about a yard, maybe a half yard shy of a first down.
Well, if you're Kentucky, you say, that's okay, because we got a fourth down.
It's almost 2 yards shy.
Well, watch this. Little crossing pattern. See him open right there. Bang. Throw the ball. And look at the accuracy of the ball. And you know, you have to give credit to a wide receiver, Robinson, number 9. Anytime you go across that center, you know that strong safety is going to blast you, but he just looks it in.
No settling for 3 here. Fourth down and 2. Homer and White are the setbacks. Now Simon in there as well. Homer slips.
Interesting call there. It was a misdirection play, and when Homer took the football, they ran in trying to get the middle linebacker to play on the first back. Fred White comes up. He's the strong safety. He makes the play. Now watch this. Misdirection right here. You come up the middle right there. Now give it back to him, and you hope that he can cut to the outside. When he slipped right there, it allowed Tennessee, with that great team speed, to react back to the football. Again, right there you see the slip where he goes down the wet field. The Chip talked about is from about the 30-yard line in, right in the center. That's exactly where he slipped.
First and 10, Tennessee at their 12. Jamal Lewis in the backfield along with Bryson, and Jamal gets it and stopped by Marvin Major, number 98, the junior, and you see an injured Volunteer. That looks like Jarvis Rito, number 72, junior out of Marrero, Louisiana, played at Shaw High School there. Have a timeout with 7:18 remaining here in the third. Peyton Manning's lead is 10. It is a 10-point lead for Tennessee. Jarvis Rito injured before the timeout. He has been taken off the field. Let's go back to that play on 4th and 2. You decide to go for it but not air it out. If you give yourself no opportunity at the end zone, would it not be perhaps a better choice to kick the 3?
Well, I think so. I think if you're not going to pass the football for that first down, run it 2 yards, especially what Tennessee did on that situation. They blitzed. They brought a lot of people up in the line. I think you pass the football.
They were going to try to get pressure on Couch. It didn't work, especially when he slipped. When Homer slipped, the play was over.
Certainly hard to be critical against Hal Mumme, who has energized football in this state. But in that situation, given their ability in throwing the football, an interesting call. Marcus Nash on the receiving end beyond the 20-yard line.
Boy, you know, when you've been burned as much as Marcus Nash has burned Kentucky, you want to stay back, but you've got to come up quick. Once you get that plant foot, you've got to come up. Nash with, what, 164 yards on six receptions? He's burned them big time today.
Third down, a little more than a yard. Bryson and Lewis are the backs. Rolling left, he's got Bryson.
Boy, now that play has been there a couple of times for Manning today.
Well, it wasn't pretty. But you see that they're giving Peyton Manning the left side of the field. That's where his uncovered man is. It wasn't pretty, but he dumped it to him, got the first down.
Let's go down to Chip Gardner.
Hey, Tim, Al Wilson has put the sweatpants on. He's got a hat and a towel wrapped around his neck. He's looking more like a coach than a player. Obviously, the linebacker's out with a sprained ankle, but I'll tell you what, I don't know how sprained it is, because after that fourth down stop by the Tennessee defense, he was jumping up and down as if he was on a pogo stick. But they'd love to have him in there, I know.
Injured in the second quarter of the Arkansas game, and some confusion for Tennessee offensively. Manning forced to call a timeout.
Yeah, the play clock was running down. He had to call a timeout, used one of them.
7:03 left in the third. Only one touchdown thus far in the second half. For the defensive second half. Back after a local word. 31-21. Tennessee with a 10-point lead, and you see the top five crowds, and look at that. Today, 61,076 paid, topping the number for Louisville a year ago, and of course, four of the top five this year with Hal Mumme Bowl.
They're averaging over 59,000.
That'll get a contract extension for you. Lewis is wide open. Run down by Ryan Murphy, number 59, the freshman from Moeller High in Cincinnati, Ohio.
Well, we talked about the left side. I know it sounds like a broken record, but what they're doing is they're doubling up on the outside receivers. They're trying to take away Nash, and look how wide open, just wide open Jamal Lewis is, because they can't cover everybody when they double cover on Nash and, of course, Copeland if he's in there. So they're just hoping that they can get to the quarterback before he looks downfield and sees Jamal Lewis. That's what worked.
This is a Kentucky defense that now really needs to cause a turnover. Peerless Price. Peerless Price inside the five, down to the two. And you're beginning to see how weary this Kentucky defense has now become. Too many snaps to play against a powerful offensive juggernaut like this one.
Yeah, it was a good block there by Coleman, the right tackle. He blocks out Eric Kelly, the left linebacker, and kind of springs this play. Mosey's the right tackle. He does a good job getting out in that flat, getting that penetration, and then you just kind of duck back behind his block. But all of a sudden, you see where Tennessee's starting to take a little bit more control.
Over 400 yards in the air for Manning. Jamal Lewis did not get in, trying to go over the top and could not. We mentioned it earlier that this is a Kentucky defense that has grown weary in the second half of many games. And for Peyton Manning, the 300-plus yard games, got plenty of them. Number one in the SEC in that category, 403 today. Go ahead and book the room not far from the downtown athletic club. I believe it was booked a long time ago.
Oh, I believe they might have booked that at the end of last year.
Yep. Major, very concerned, the defensive coordinator. This is his worst nightmare. Defense has been on the field too long. Lewis, touchdown, Tennessee.
Oh, you talk about getting up. Jamal Lewis is not only fast, look how high he gets up on that leap. He actually goes over top of the pile about 4 feet in the air. Again, watch him here. Now, there was a big scuffle at the tail end of this play, and you see him leap from about 3 yards out. Kind of a fight or something, a scuffle going on down there as we look at that replay.
Getting a little ugly down there. Snediger in the middle of it.
cooler heads beginning to prevail.
Well, Snedeker's, they've all played hard. You see the yellow flag in the background, that's usually offsetting. But they've all played hard. Let me tell you, this has been an outstanding football game. A lot of offense, and Snedeker's got a lot of pride.
I'm wondering if he hasn't been ejected.
Well, he's coming over to the sideline.
Yes, he is. He and Diagu got into it, the tight end, number 82. Anytime you see the official come over.
We had offsetting personal fouls against both teams. The two players have been ejected from the game.
Yep, gone. And that is a huge loss for Kentucky. Tennessee seldom uses its tight ends, but Snedeker is absolutely necessary for Mike Major's defense. So a loss of composure for the sophomore from Salesville, Ohio.
Well, Major, the coach, told us yesterday, he said Snedeker, he has played, he's had a left shoulder injury all year long. He's played with aspirin and heart all year long. Let me tell you, some great athletes don't want to be embarrassed. He's had five tackles today, he's had a sack, he's been all over the football field, and he's their leader. Now, all of a sudden, they've got to have somebody else step up if they're going to stay in this football game.
This is a trade-off you don't want if you're Hal Munna.
Oh, no.
I mean, Diagu, very seldom used tight end. They also have Peebles and Johnson that they can use. Tennessee. But Snedeker, very upset, still being consoled by his teammates along the sidelines. And you've reached a point now where Kentucky is in a must-score mode. When you start getting into a shootout against a team like Tennessee, 38-21 our score. It is a 17-point Volunteers lead. Philip Fulmer talking about Peyton Manning as a Heisman Trophy winner. He certainly agrees he's the man.
If there's a better one out there, I don't know of him. Peyton has done everything that the Heisman is supposed to be, supposed to stand for. He means the most to our football team. He's led our football team. He statistically obviously has the numbers that are out there that are capable of winning that. If you see the past Heisman winners have done.
Peyton Manning, still very intense. He knows there's a lot of work left to be done, but how about that for a day's work? A couple of days' work.
Averaging 20 yards per completion. Truly his best day this year, 400 yards. That's quite a mark.
We saw his poorest game of the year against South Carolina. And you know what they were able to do? They were able to disguise their defensive coverages, much like a Woody Woodenhopper would at Vanderbilt, who, by the way, is next up for Peyton Manning next week in Knoxville. High sky kick yet again. Fair catch is called for by Gary Davis. And the ball will be at the 30-yard line for Kentucky. Tim Couch has got to answer the bell. The numbers certainly worthy of an heir apparent to the Heisman Trophy. If, in fact, Manning does get it this year, Couch will be a leading candidate next season.
Well, you know, it's amazing as we look at Tim Couch there, they could not make mistakes and stay in this football game. A couple things really crucial. That interception was crucial, the one, the controversial interception, and, of course, the missed opportunity at the end of the half. That's a 10-point swing. They get that, they're only 7 points down.
You're right. And they must score here. Homer.
Only about a yard for Derek Homer.
And you hear a restless crowd because they're saying, we want to see Tim Couch throw the football. That's what they do so well. You see Hal Mummy sneaking into play, kind of signaling in the play to him. And that's what Tim Couch does so well. Throw the yeast, throw the Sanford on that underneath, go long, maybe keep him, find Mickelson on a fly pattern. But they need to throw the football to stay in this football game.
Energize this crowd again.
Yes.
They need to be successful in this sequence.
His pass is to White. He's got a blocker in front of him. Raynock Thompson runs him down.
Well, I just have to compliment the Kentucky offensive line. They've given Tim Couch a lot of time. He goes from the shotgun. That gives him an extra set. But you see there, Webster, one of the big men up front. You got Watts, Schlarman, Comstock, and leading. And they just keep on keeping people out. Look, you see right there running around the outside. At number 70 is Comstock. Boy, he's played well. Just keep on running them wide and allow Couch to find the underneath receivers, the crossing patterns. There's the big man. 6'8", 315-pound junior.
You're
the kid.
Your kind of guy.
First and 10 at midfield. Couch with time. Steps up. There's Yeast. Down to the 14-yard line. And the crowd is, in fact, energized.
Absolutely.
speed.
There's an old saying, you got to dance with the girl you brung. And the pass game has gotten Kentucky where they are. And look at the time again. Look downfield. Find the receiver. Just make that little curl pattern at about 15 to 17 yards. Break that coverage. Sprint downfield. All of a sudden, he's got some yards.
Didn't have a catch until the last drive of the first half. From the 14, first and 10.
How many teams have you seen down 17 points and the fans still think they're in this game, they're going to win?
Counts has room to run.
You know, Thompson had an angle on Couch, and he was still able to out-quick him and almost go untouched out of bounds.
Yeah. Well, you're right. Couch is a big guy, 6'5", about 220 pounds, but he runs. He's got great speed. Picks up a few yards, gets positive yards.
2 yards on the pickup, second and 8 from the 12. Yeast and Kevin Coleman in the game at wideout, along with Jimmy Robinson. Coleman flanked up to the top, Yeast to the bottom of your screen. Slant. Oh, the crowd's going to go wild on that one. Coleman was definitely touched by Noel, but no flag.
No flag on the play, little crossing pattern. Coleman thought that he was held. I think everybody in the stadium thought he was tackled before. Watch him, number 19, right to left. Crossing pattern here. When's the contact come? Oh, I think that's a good call by the official. I really do. I think right there, you see, there's no hand on right there. Just getting in there. I think that's a good call.
Well, you know, he reached with his right hand prematurely, but did not make contact.
Exactly.
I think the crowd thought that that right hand got in there too soon, but he did not make contact. Incomplete. Robinson just stopped his pattern there.
He did. Well, I wonder why he stopped his pattern. As he was coming on a crossing pattern, I wonder if he got hit and knocked off his pattern, but Robinson just stopped.
A perplexed look from Tim Couch.
Watch, left to right on your screen. Look at number 9. He just stopped. You see right there? You got to run. You got to run to that middle pattern. Fourth down.
No,
I think you got to kick the field goal.
They're going to take the field goal.
Yeah, it's a little bit far to go. His longest of the year is only 30 yards.
At this stage, you have to realize that you've got to get some points in this situation, which brings to mind, why didn't you go for 3 the last time you were down here? 29-yard drive. And it is good for Seth Hansen. So points to keep your team and your crowd in it is very important. And the crowd continues to boo over that missed call that they felt perhaps was there when Noel got to Kevin Coleman.
Well, you know, this is a big one, but boy, do we have a big
number of key games today. Arkansas leading Mississippi State. I had felt going in today that that was a game. Arkansas played perhaps one of their best games against Tennessee last week. And now Georgia leading Ole Miss 14-7 in the second. The wild, wild west really impacted by those two games. LSU has the week off, and they figure to be a beneficiary if Alabama can pull a surprise in the Iron Bowl later this evening. And that's what the Tigers need. And they, of course, are watching what's going on both with Auburn and Alabama tonight and the two Mississippi schools this afternoon.
Well, you know, you talk about perfect football. Peyton Manning has played perfect football. Tennessee has played perfect football in this game. Not thrown, they've not had interceptions. They've not put the ball on the ground. And that's what Kentucky's got to hold.
Onside kick.
Beautiful job.
Taken by Tennessee's up back, Graf Corby. They had the good hands people up there. Corby is a young receiver, junior from Webb High School in Knoxville, Tennessee. Now, this is something that has been utilized by Mummy many times at this stage of a game throughout the course of this season.
Boy, look how close that was, but great concentration. That was a great kick. And they tried to catch Tennessee by surprise, but again, Tennessee continues to play errorless football. They've not made a mistake.
Virtually penalty free.
Yeah.
No penalties at all against Tennessee today. There's that quick pitch pattern up to Copeland. And
And Germain inside the 40 to the 38-yard line.
Eddie's pass.
Be sure to visit the official internet site of the Southeastern Conference for up-to-date stats, game previews, coaches' comments, and a lot more. The SEC online at secsports.com. You know, watching the onside kick, and again, Kyle Mummy was criticized somewhat earlier this year when he tried that against both Florida and Georgia. But he understands that the snap situation for his defense is there.
Well, his defense has played hard. They've been out there a lot of snaps.
Lewis inside the 35 to the 31. That'll be another Volunteers first down. But the point we need to make relative to that decision is that Tennessee now has 48 offensive plays, and he believes that his defense can only play effectively for 60 snaps in a game.
That's what he said, 55 to 60, and we just start wearing down. And you're going to see the climate change for Tennessee right now. I mean, I know that Peyton Manning is having a wonderful day, but I think it's a little bit more Jamal Lewis time. Control the line of scrimmage. And all of a sudden, you see Kentucky start to bring a lot of people up.
Play fake. They bite. Post pattern. Touchdown. Marcus Nash's third of the day. A little salute for Peyton Manning from Marcus Nash. Did you see that? Look at that. And McCullough gives one as well.
Well, when have you seen a better day by quarterbacks than this? Watch this. Little fake into the line right here. Now pull it out, throw it up, and just let him run under. And it's a perfect pass. Look at this. Right on the money.
Third touchdown reception of the day for Nash. 12 on the season.
You know what I saw Littleton Ward doing? He put his hands out as if he didn't get that foot down in bounds. But when he had the football, he broke the plane. He didn't have, when he came down with the football, he was still in bounds. He had that left foot down.
Ball makes it a 45-24 Tennessee lead. And again, the play fake to Lewis, all that's needed for the rest of that Kentucky defense to bite. And you're on an island here with Marcus Nash.
Oh, you are. Now watch this, good concentration. Now right there, he catches the ball. You see the foot down. The other foot comes out of bounds. You see Littleton Ward saying no. But Peyton Manning says that's a score.
Peyton Manning, young man that made a choice that many would never be able to make. And you have to credit in some part his own appreciation of the college game, the college experience. And again, the family in which he was raised, they had something going for them that a number of great athletes don't have. And that is the resources that he would not have to make the cash right now. And that, I think, afforded him the opportunity to love the game of college football and play it one last time at the collegiate level. We've got an injured official.
Well, they've been running so hard, the officials have had to run. I think he may have pulled a hamstring.
By the way, Manning's five touchdowns thrown today ties a school record. He had five against Texas Tech earlier in the year.
Tim, on the tail end of that play, there was an unsportsmanlike conduct against Tennessee. And it may have been that saluting.
Yeah, the celebration.
Yeah. And they marked the ball back, so Tennessee will kick off from about the 20-yard line. But I don't think that bothers Peyton Manning and company. Look at that, 439 yards, five touchdowns. And you know what? We still got almost 2.5 minutes. They've had three drives this half, and I believe they've all gone for touchdowns.
So obviously the flag comes down. We're talking about Marcus Nash in the weekend before Tua Day started this summer. He married Laurie Holloway in Chattanooga. Defensive end and fellow Tulsa native Jonathan Brown was the best man. Peyton Manning in attendance. And fellow
illegal
receivers.
Illegal procedure against the kicking team for kicking it out of bounds. The receiving team gets 30 yards in advance. Kick, 50 yards.
Peerless Bryce and Andy McCullough, they were groomsmen at the ceremony. Laurie's father was the minister there. He took a little ribbing after making such a crucial decision in his life before Tua Day.
Well, I loved Peyton Manning's advice to him. He said, don't lock your knees. You'll go down. If you lock your knees, you're going down.
He's sitting down now. And after that kick went out of bounds, rather than getting it to 35, because of where the kickoff was from, they get it at midfield with the Wildcats. Sanford looking for some room. Ball is loose.
Tennessee believes they have it.
No, I think it went back to Kentucky. I think he may have been down before the his knee may have been down.
So Kentucky retains possession at the 47-yard line, a gain of three.
Well, here's again, watch this. You try to pick up those big linemen now. You dodge one. Now just get as many yards as you can. You see his knees down there. Now the ball comes out. The tail end of the play, the ball comes out, and everybody scrambles for it, but truly his knee was down. You know what I think about the Tim Couch and Company is what in the world is going to be like when they build this defense to stop the other team's offense. Wow, what an offensive show.
Incomplete.
Oh, got to be a flag on that one. He tackled him.
And they did it.
Yeah, there had to be a flag on that. Yeast was tackled. You cannot go through a player. You can go to him, but you can't go through him.
We've talked today a great deal about what's at stake for Tennessee, and there's plenty at stake.
Holding against the defense, 10 yards from the line of scrimmage, plus an automatic first down.
Watch Couch on the tail end of this. Been under a little bit of pressure. Not a whole lot, but right there just gets knocked down. Good rush in there. That's Corey Terry, number 22, rushes in there. He's the right end.
First and 10 at the 37 now of Tennessee. And
now watch the hold here. Yeah. See, you can't hold on to him right there. That's tackling. I mean, that's one way to cover him. Terry Ferry, you got to let go of him a little bit.
Couch for White. Out of bounds at the 22-yard line. You can tell that there's no quit in this Kentucky team. We touched on what Tennessee has at stake. For Kentucky, the Motor City Bowl, Detroit, about a 338-mile, five-hour drive. Very interested in an SEC team with six Division I-A victories, and they would have that if they were to win today at 6-5. In fact, we could have as many as eight bowl-eligible teams out of the Southeastern Conference this year.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. There's a lot of teams would love to have this offense that Tim Couchin is having.
You mean a lot of bowls?
A lot of bowls that would love to see that type of offense.
Couch in trouble. And they finally get to him. Jonathan Brown's 10th
Couch
sack
may be hurt. Couch may be hurt. When he went down, I thought he may have gotten hurt. You see right there, he gets up. Whenever a quarterback squinches up like that, kind of pulls his body up, I thought he got hurt. But he's a tough competitor. You're not going to see him come out of the football game. He may have fallen on the football when he went down. He's trying to avoid, again, looking downfield. This is a good rush. Jonathan Brown, good pressure on him right there on the outside. And see, I think he just falls on the football right there, up in the chest. Kind of knocks your air out a little bit. You see the ball comes out, but, and look at him, trying to take that deep breath. Get those lungs expanded back again.
Lead handoff to Homer. Tennessee has not read that play, right?
Yeah.
Kentucky was able to pull it off in the first half, but not in this situation.
And you know what I think that was for Tim Couch? I think that was just let me have one kind of a breather. Just let me have one deep inhale, and now we'll get back to the offense. You know, it's amazing. We've had all this offense. We've talked about them not giving up. We still have another quarter of football.
And in order to stay in it, they're obviously going to have to come up with some turnovers. So far, Tennessee just playing mistake-free football.
Stepping up, has it picked by Terry Fair.
That is not at all the way Kentucky wanted this quarter to come to an end. Terry Fair with his second interception of this afternoon. The first one debatable, not this one.
Well, Couch zeroes in. He gets that pressure. He steps up in the pocket, but he really zeroes in his wide receiver right here. And Fair just cuts in front of him and takes it away from Craig Yeast. Big turnover. And he knows it right away. Look at him. You see him just unbuckle that chin strap?
Still a quarter to play. But they're singing Rocky Top with illusions of an SEC title and an Alliance Bowl bid in their future. 45-24. Tennessee leads, and they now have the football as we look at that last pick to close out the third.
Well, watch Fair play in the top corner. Couch at the bottom. He zeroes in on. Look at Fair. Recovery time. The ball just thrown just the tail end. You see in the bottom picture, you see Couch taking off that chin strap. He knows it. Just tried to force one in there when it wasn't there, and that's something he's not done very much today.
You mentioned in your rewinds
pound the football. It may be just that time for Tennessee offensively now. And Kentucky's got to start gambling. So.
Yeah, they do. They've got to bring up their backers, hope that they can pull a ball clear. They've got to get outside. They've got to stop a series here.
Jamal Lewis beyond the 20 to the 22-yard line. Let's go downstairs to check.
Thanks a lot, Tim. You know, Tim Couch pulled off the chin chops disgustingly, but his teammates all came over and rallied behind him to a man. His entire offense came over, either tapped his helmet or tapped him on the back saying, forget it, we still got a quarter left of football to play, and they certainly do, and it could be a wild one.
He rebounded, you'll recall, from the call made by the official on the first Terry Fair pickoff, and maybe he can do the same here in the fourth quarter.
Well, let me give you a little stat for those fans at home. 500 yards for each team. Tennessee with 517. Kentucky with 504.
Fearless Price. It's the reverse. Add to the tote board offensively. As Price has run down at the 42-yard line. Well, it's pretty obvious now that David Cutcliffe, the offensive coordinator for Tennessee, and Philip Fulmer are in agreement. 45 is not enough when you've got Couch throwing on the other sideline.
See Price coming in motion out the outside right there now. Get the little handoff, get outside. You see the big lineman coming downfield? Good blocks downfield there. Webster, 67, gets a good block, just kicks him out. I need to tell you, this is unbelievable. 1,021 yards at the end of three quarters. We still have another quarter to go.
Well, Chad Clifton did make a good block there. You're right. First down and 10 at the 42-yard line of Kentucky. Step drop in a fade pattern for McCullum. Down at the two. What a remarkable catch. Flags are down. Flag down at the line of scrimmage. Near the line of scrimmage at the 42-yard line.
Andy McCullum.
Defense, offside, penalty declined. First down.
Al Ford tells you that that one's against Kentucky, and the Volunteers are in great shape.
Well, you'll see it on split screen right here. Going downfield, just looking back, making the defensive back turn. Look at Manning. See how high his arch is right there? Left corner's Kelly, number 20. Look at this. Great concentration right there, trying to pull the ball in. And that's exactly what you want to do. I thought there was almost a face mask at the tail end of it.
Certainly he was interfered with. Yeah. Still made the catch. Lewis fumbles it. Kentucky's got it. Down and a lateral to Kelly. Robert Jones came up with the recovery. This will be ruled perhaps a muff.
And Peyton Manning is down.
We'll see. That was a forward lateral later.
Backward pass on the play. The defense can recover, but they cannot advance.
Exactly.
First down here for Kentucky.
Exactly. Good call by Al Ford. When I said muff, that's what I meant. You cannot return that.
That's right. Backward pass. That means that's the quarterback throws the ball back to the wide receiver. Watch this play. Throws it back to him. Now, you can recover, but you cannot advance it. Right there, the official's making the call. But I was more interested. I saw Peyton Manning coming down here on the tail end of the play. Look at him trying to make this touchdown, this catch. And I thought he got hit because he kind of limped over to the sideline, but now I see he's all back. There's the backwards pass. Good pickup right here. This is what Kentucky needed. They needed some kind of a break. That's Robert Jones, 92. Laterals the football. Now you see Manning coming in right there. No quitting that hard.
That was a legal lateral, by the way, to Kelly. But, but it was an illegal fumble return. Off a muff, you can't do that on a backwards pass. Tipped into the air. Ray Knock Thompson has it. Now he laterals. And Kentucky gets it back.
Oh, no. Gotta be kidding me.
Tim Couch actually came back up with the football.
Well, what happened on the play? The tip ball, it was intercepted. Corey Curry was the one who tipped it on the line. He's number 22. He's going to tip it right in your screen. Right there's the tip. Raynaud Thompson's going to get the football, 46. Watch, he tries the lateral to Bear. The ball bounces into the hands of Tim Couch. That is incredible. You talk about excitement. Look at this right here. There's the lateral. And watch Tim Couch come in the picture. He's going to get rushing yards.
There's one for the highlight reel. You might want to check your 11:30 news tonight.
Wow.
You'll see a few plays from this game. First and 10, Kentucky.
after a bizarre play at their own 24. Homer. Well, after 97 yards for Homer on the ground in the first half, he's been held under 10 so far here in the second half. Corey Terry, very active defensively for the Volunteers, making another stop.
Well, a lot of MVPs out there today. This has been a game of MVPs. It's just been stirring. This is just an incredible half of football.
Homer only 6 yards on the ground this half after 97 in the first half. Couch to Sanford.
Oh, I saw a face mask.
Late marker comes down. Tennessee along the sidelines continued to drive him out of bounds. Raynock Thompson started it all, and Gerald Griffin in there.
Look at the mud on Couch's helmet. He got hit after the ball. I'm wondering now, I saw the face mask. I didn't see a penalty flag back on where Couch got hit, but Couch just...
5 yards face mask against the defense, added on to the end of the run, first down.
Now watch the tail end of this play. You're going to see Couch. He's going to get leveled right there. Boom, down he goes. Just going to get rolled over. Now the face mask was on the tackle. The face mask might have been against Gerald Griffin, the left cornerback, number 18. That was nice of the ref to help him up. You know, it's amazing. When you start thinking of offensive games like this, we've got over 1,000 yards at the end of the third quarter. You think, what's the record? The record, 1,560 yards. And you know what? Couch got leveled again.
And the penalty marker down as White is interfered with. Jermaine White, the intended receiver, Gerald Griffin, will be flagged again.
Well, let me tell you about that game. That game before was TCU.
Defensive pass interference. 15 yards from the line of scrimmage. Automatic first down.
That offensive game I was referring to was back in 1989, TCU Houston. Total offense, 1,560 yards. We may see it. You see right there, you see, boom, Corey Terry just levels him. You see the interference right there. Hey, this has just been an amazing game. It's gotten out of breath, Scotty.
It's gotten your dander up. This is the last time you and I'll be together. Oh. You're getting the most out of it today.
Oh, man, I'm telling you, I haven't seen offense like this in a long while.
Pass incomplete, intended for Yeast. Thrown at his feet that time by Couch. Next week, Bob Kessling will move into the booth for the Egg Bowl to join up with my partner, Dave Rowe, the excitable Dave Rowe. And John Avery is that and more. He and the Ole Miss Rebels taking on J.J. Johnson, Mississippi and Mississippi State. And the West standings, you could have 3 losses and perhaps manage to make it to the championship game in Atlanta against, in all likelihood, Tennessee if they can hold serve today and next week against Vanderbilt. Over the middle and caught by Robinson. Jimmy Robinson has been a favorite target today. Youngster from Georgia Military Academy. Junior college transfer. Sophomore, 6'3", 195-pounder.
And now you're going to see hurry-up offense. Referee calls a timeout, maybe to measure. But Couch and company, they were trying to rush up the line. You know, while we got a minute, I got to tell you, we talked about MVPs. How about our MVP last night?
Carol Van Norman.
Carol Van Norman. She won our outstanding, kind of one of the crew. I mean, she's the infamy operator, does a lot of graphics for us, and she's worked those busy fingers all year. And congratulations to her. Outstanding choice.
Has to sit next to Todd Menhinnett.
That's enough
that warrants,
right there.
That warrants MVP right
Todd,
there.
Todd Menhinnett, of course, our associate producer, who sits behind Ken Dennis. Now, that's another chore, sitting behind Ken Dennis.
Third down, less than a yard. Ken is our director.
Who sits next to Rob Reichley, right? Let's see, who have we got? We've got Kelly, and we've got Robin. That's the only other two other people.
Homer gets it down to the 35-yard line, Derek Homer. He's up to 10 yards rushing in the second half. After 97 in the first half, down by 3 touchdowns, but Kentucky looking for a strike here. They need 7. They did get the turnover that they needed, but they're going to need a few more if they are to really make this one a challenge for the Volunteers in the latter stages.
Well, I think what's incredible about Kentucky, and let's face it, this Tennessee team is an outstanding football team. But the thing about Kentucky is there's no quitting. They don't know what that word is.
White. Anthony White. Stopped by Dwayne Goodrich. Both he and Duff were injured early in this game. And
They've managed to make it back in there. We've seen, though, Tennessee's depth defensively. A real factor here because they've got fresh legs. You see people like Gerald Griffin in the game. Obviously, Sean Johnson's been able to help them quite a bit.
Well, I think one of the real true marks of Tennessee's defense is, of course, in their depth, is losing somebody like Al Wilson and being able to recover from his loss.
Couch feels the pressure, decides to tuck it. Haley came over to pop Little and keep him off of the back of his quarterback. As Couch comes out of the mud along the sideline.
That was a funny block by Haley. He's the tight end number 37. And let me tell you, Leonard Little just ran right on through it. It was a good block. Watch 37. He's on number one. He's going to come out here. Now, what Leonard Little does so well is react back to the football. You're going to see Leonard Little, number one, come in here. And look at this. There's a little bang, but it doesn't even deter Leonard Little. He's great speed, tremendous football player. Came back from just a devastating injury last year. You talk about working hard, and he's just had a fantastic year.
First and 10 at the 21. Marker down as White. Homer may have moved prematurely. That may be why we have the flag. White had it. He was stopped behind the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, I think Derek Homer moved early. He was fullback on the play. He's going to block, and he kind of came out of his stance, and he knew it right away. Almost stopped.
Buxton, you see, is also in the game now, backing up Ron Green this afternoon.
Illegal motion. Against the offense. 5 yards. Still first down.
You know, I talked about that 1,560 yards total offense. I was there that game. I'll never forget. I believe it was Klingler. I know it was TCU and Houston, the running gun and all that. Just 1,000 yards passing in the game. It was just an incredible game. But this game is getting kind of close to it. May challenge it. Not going to beat it. It may be number two.
Yeast up at the top of the screen. Checked by Terry Fair, and now Jermaine White in motion. Looking for White. And there was contact and no flag. Gerald Griffin got tied up. It could have been incidental, perhaps, in the minds of the officials.
Well, I know.
But Hal Mummy very upset about it because, in essence, his receiver was tripped.
Well, he was. He was tripped, just dead tripped right off the road. It is incidental. Watch this inside. Watch 28. You see him go to the outside. Now,
he reaches for the flag, and then, oh, my.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
Yeah, again.
That's pretty amazing.
Look at Couch. He's saying, wait a minute. Hold a second. That's got to be interference. I know it's incidental contact, but you can't run through a wide receiver. You can't trip him and run through.
Why suddenly the discretion, says Hal Mummy? You know, in many respects, and we should point this out, college basketball officiating has, been affected by teams that press a great deal. And I think that this has got to be the toughest type of game to officiate that you could possibly have in college football.
Well, you got so many wide receivers going all over the field. You've got pass rushing. You haven't seen many holding calls on the offensive line. That's really a tribute to Kentucky. That has been, I think that's been one of their strong points.
Well, when they pick up the box score at the end of this one and see how penalty-free Tennessee for the most part has been, it'll be brought up. Couch looking deep. Incomplete. Looking for Robinson, and Couch is now hitting the deck virtually every play.
That time they brought the strong safety, Fred White, number two, on a blitz, outside blitz, and he's just going to hit. Watch number two, right of your screen. He's just going to level Couch. Tail end, look how long Couch holds the football. Excuse me, that was Corey Terry, number 22. I thought that was two. Two's out there on the reception. That was good cover. And again, Tim Couch under pressure, five hurries, five knockdowns. Only two sacks. That has been a lot in the second half. Tennessee has known that they've had to pass the football.
Couch in trouble. Lets it go late for Sanford. Look at this. What an amazing play. On both ends, both by Couch, who had Duff draped all over him. And then by Sanford, who gets it done on his own.
Watch this pass. This reminds me of Kenny Stabler with the underhand pass. Look at this. Bill Duff is number 50. He's going to get the rush. Look at this. Throw it underhand. Just throw it out there. Sanford comes up with a big catch. Brings down, instead of being fourth down in about 16, brings down a fourth down in 2 or 3 yards.
Thinking of Clarence Davis from Stabler. Is that?
No, the one where Banaszak dribbled in and Casper recovered.
Casper, okay. Fourth down and three. Couch. Pass Haley. First and goal, Kentucky.
All right, this has been a courageous drive by Tim Couch and this Kentucky offense. Just amazing. Tim Couch and company, no quitting him. Look at him in that huddle. See the leader, again, moving around in the pocket, looking downfield. He's fearless, throws the ball out there, strike. And boy, his receivers, once they get that football, they don't drop him.
First and goal at the seven.
You remember that fourth down where you wanted to pass the football? Maybe they would like to have that one back.
Coleman. No signal.
I think he was down.
Yep.
He was trying to stretch for the goal line, but I believe he was down when he was stretching. The official's right there in good position to make the call. Said his knee was down. Look at Couch and company. Cool in the pocket. Look downfield. Spin the ball around. Bang. Dribble one right there. Now watch the tail end of this. Just try to stretch for the goal line. Right there. The ground cannot call. The ground cannot cause a fumble. Now Couch thought he stretched in there for a touchdown.
Second and goal at the one. Homer and A.J. Simon now in the backfield. It's White. Touchdown, Kentucky. This drive, win or lose, is one well worth remembering if you're a Kentucky fan.
Oh, it's just big man on big man, just driving, stretch, get in there. And as you said, there's no quitting Kentucky. There's no quitting Tennessee. We've had 75 points, and we still have over 9 minutes left.
Hansen's extra point is good. It's the first touchdown of this half for the Big Blue. Tennessee leading it 45-31. 9:02 to play here in the fourth. Chances are this one will take a while, and you see the other scores. Arkansas trying to pull the upset. 4-point underdog taking on Mississippi State today. Georgia now leading 21-7 at the half. Those two games very important to a lot of talk with regard to where the Western Division champion that could eventually lose perhaps to Tennessee in a championship game if that were to happen, where they would go come bowl time. Look at that.
Look at last year.
Last year versus this year. Total yards. Pretty incredible.
Well, Tennessee's getting close to their total, but look at Kentucky. What's that, 1,150 yards total offense or more? That's incredible.
Total offense, two-thirds of a mile. Two-thirds of a mile today. Samuel preparing to kick off now. Obviously, you're thinking on sides here, and that good hands crew is up there for Tennessee. Jermaine Copeland, among others. Mark Levine, they're all 10 yards away. Well, they fake it. They go the other way with it. A great play, but it's recovered by Tennessee. Gerald Griffin takes it out of bounds near midfield.
But there's
Samuel to Hansen. Samuel fakes and then Hansen kicks it away. And then we've got a flag. You'd think perhaps
offside, kicking team, penalty declined. Tennessee's ball, first and 10.
Well, what you're trying to do there, Tim, is you're trying to get that front line to react over to where they think the kick is going to go. And a lot of times you'll get that, and that was just a miss, a cross. That was a heck of a call.
There's nothing conventional about this Hal Mumme coach team. But yet you do give up half of the field when you consistently onside kick. He's done it now each of the last two times after touchdowns and that field goal. And there is Copeland. Down the sideline at the 15-yard line, Littleton Ward trips him up.
Boy, what a good call by Peyton Manning. A crossing pattern, misdirection. Watch him come off the right of your screen. Bang, just kind of cross right there. Just hit him. You're not going to cover him with a backer. Lee Wesley, number 34, has got him one-on-one out of the backfield. That's not going to happen. For Manning, over 500 yards passing now.
514 yards passing for Peyton Manning.
We still got a lot of time left.
We're getting up there around Ty Detmer-like stats when he was at BYU in single games. Copeland works his way down to the 5-yard line. Tremaine Martin making his 10th sack tackle of the day. Number 26, the senior from Apopka, Florida, Henry Clay High School.
And I think Bud Ford, the SID from Tennessee, has signaled down, has told Philip Fulmer exactly what the yardage is needed for Peyton Manning. Look at that. Career high for Peyton Manning, 524. And look at that, the two today. Couch with 423, Manning with 524. That's 947 yards, and we still have 8 minutes left.
Lewis down to the two.
Well, we build this game at the top as a game matching up the Heisman frontrunner against the heir to the throne, and it has certainly lived up to that advancability.
Well, you know, an interesting thing, and you made mention, as we see a late flag, and this may be unsportsmanlike conduct as we look at Tim Couch, and we'll wait for the call. But you brought up an interesting thing. Tim Couch, I believe, has already said, I'm going to stay in school for 4 years.
He's now
kind of inferred.
Unsportsmanlike conduct against the defense, half the distance, first down.
He made the point that Peyton Manning may have changed things where college athletes are concerned, and he may heed that call that Manning made. Here again is a look at the unsportsmanlike.
Well, you see Ginn right there, David Ginn being kind of tackled, felt he was being tackled right there. Maybe that was what they called
it. A little bit of the face mask. Yeah. Lewis again. Touchdown, Tennessee. Second touchdown for the freshman from Atlanta this afternoon.
Well, big man on big man up front. Just let Jamal Lewis just plow through there. What a different Tennessee football team this is with Jamal Lewis at running back. We showed that stat the first three games and the last three. He's just an outstanding running back, just a freshman, true freshman. He's got three more years if he stays too. But, you know, you talk about that Peyton Manning decision to stay. I thought that was one of the great calls by a college player. I just really thought that was quite a tribute to Peyton, to his family, just to everyone.
Hall tacks on the extra point, and the Tennessee lead back to 21. And the fireworks offensively roll on. Philip Fulmer, very happy to have Peyton one last year. He is having it's been a top-flight SEC game today. As Tennessee leads at 52-31, amassing all kinds of records, perhaps moving in not only on all-time SEC marks in a single game, but maybe even all-time NCAA Division I records. Again, the sky kick, fair caught by Gary Davis, who may have a record for most fair catches on kickoffs today. And let's go down to Chip Kerr.
Hey, Tim. Tim Couch was warming up the hand just before this series starts because on his last drive, he somehow sliced some of his fingers open on his throwing hand. He wanted to come over. They wanted to put a bandage on it. He waved that off, and all he wanted to do was throw the football around a little bit before he hits the field. So it looks like it's going to be okay.
There you see the comparison. And by the way, it'll be in every paper across this country tomorrow. I thought coming in, it was very important for Manning today to throw up similar numbers to that of Couch. Well, he's done that and then some in terms of solidifying his Heisman trophy. Couch is sacked. They've been living in his backfield, and that last drive, he willed his team into the end zone in that last drive, and Chip commented on how banged and bruised he was before this drive got underway.
Well, his offensive linemen have given protection all day long. They just get overpowered on this play. You see the pocket just kind of collapse around Tim Couch, Leonard Little, Bill Duff, number 50 in there. They just kind of crush the pocket down. But for Couch, it's bounce back up time.
You talk about a headache. John Chavis and staff getting one, trying to defend this team, but they are up by three touchdowns now. Over the middle, there's Coleman. His roommate has a first down out to the 39-yard line.
It's almost like Tim Couch says, now how many yards does Peyton Manning have passing? 500 and what? Wait a minute. It's my turn with the ball. You're right. Look across that field. Find that crossing pattern. Bang. Nail that ball to him. Just keep that drive going, and Coleman does it.
You think on the phone there with Cutcliffe,
what could you say to him?
Probably just keep doing whatever you're doing.
Exactly. Yeah. Just keep on keeping on.
Lead handoff again to Homer. Derek Homer breaks free. Out of bounds at the 33-yard line. And he followed his blockers all the way through. Tennessee was jamming the line of scrimmage, and there was plenty of room for him.
once he had 10 yards or more.
Boy, good block up front by Schlarman, number 65. Off the ball right there. You see the block, boom, just knocks him out right there. And then he just comes to the backside right here, just breaks the tackle, comes back against the grain, and gets the extra yardage. Mr. Touchdown or Mr. Football in Kentucky running well.
At the 32, first and 10, Kentucky. Over the middle and caught. No, now it's lost by Robinson. He had it for a moment. Pass was thrown a little behind him. Could not hang on.
And you know what's amazing? Look in the eyes of Tim Couch. I mean, when you look in the eyes of Tim Couch, he doesn't even know. He's oblivious to the score. It's just, hey, we're on offense. Give me the ball. We got to get down. We got to score. I mean, just total control. And you don't think about that when you think of sophomores running your offense.
I was at practice here on Thursday, and Hal Mumme's such a jovial fellow. You see him in practice, and it's all business. And that obviously is conveyed to Couch as well. This time he's sacked. Fourth sack of the afternoon for Tennessee. Corey Terry gets to him, number 22. And he's been pummeled by Terry in the last 10 minutes or so of this game. He's been hit by Terry, even when hurried and making completions. Well, Michigan's victory today over Ohio State, 20-14, sets up the Wolverines in the Rose Bowl, likely to play UCLA. You figure Michigan now is set. Ohio State would figure very much into the Sugar Bowl picture, a possible matchup with Tennessee. Has it inside the 30 to about the 29-yard line.
This is going to be four-down territory. You're inside. It's going to be fourth down and about 6 or 7 yards to go. You want to keep the drive alive. There's no kicking it now. You're going for scores. It's Couching Company. Looks to sideline. Gets a signal in from his coach. And it's hurry up on the line. And Couch has to call a timeout.
Timeout, Kentucky.
Fourth down and 7 coming up when we return with 4:53 remaining. And the Volunteers leading by 21. Very few have left Commonwealth Stadium with better than 60,000, the largest crowd to watch a college football game in Lexington, Kentucky, along with Chip Carter and Dave Rowe. Tim Brando, happy to have you with us. And Kentucky still gasping. They have a fourth down play coming up, 4th and 7. Nations Bank, a proud sponsor of SEC football, is your place for mortgage loans. Call 1-800-NATIONS today. Nations Bank, member FDIC, equal housing lender.
4th and 7, you've got to pass it. Look for that little crossing pattern. Maybe find Yeast. He's been hot out there. Sanford maybe on a crossing pattern, but get the ball off.
Incomplete. With 4:46 to play, the Volunteers take over. And the white flag may be going up.
I don't know about that. We're talking about competitors. Now, he's trying to force the ball into Kevin Coleman, number 19. Again, looking on that crossing pattern, he just gets a little thrown a little bit farther in front of him. Corey Gaines, of course, on the coverage. Look at Couch. He's looking for a penalty.
Tennessee has done a nice job of knocking the wide receivers for the Wildcats off their patterns, particularly here in the second half.
You know, with almost 5 minutes left, the first thing you think of, anytime you see a quarterback over 500 yards, you start to think, what's the record?
Now, going back in this game, Kentucky, you think about it, if they had 10 more points,
oh yeah,
and this is the first quarter, the first interception by Fair, at the point it's 7-3, Kentucky leading.
Yeah, they're down in four down territory.
That's an interception that was given that was not made to Terry Fair. The reverse of that, 10-7 versus potentially 14-3 for Kentucky. And then, of course, at the end of the half, trailing by 3, Hal Mumme and Tim Couch, without any timeouts, simply running out of time rather than spiking the ball. So that was a potential 3-point opportunity. They could have 10 more points and be very much in the thick of this game. Jamal Lewis.
Well, you know it's going to be crunch time now with Jamal Lewis. But I go back to that all-time SEC passing, Eric Zier, 544 yards. Peyton Manning really close to it. If I'm Philip Fulmer and I've had an impact player like Peyton Manning, I just tell him, I say, listen, you're 21 yards. I know you're not trying to run up the score, but I think you go after the 21 yards and put his name at the top of the list. He's that kind of a quarterback. But that's a tough decision for Philip Fulmer because, again, he doesn't want to run up the score, and that's what passing games kind of look like in the late stages.
Yards rushing this year for Jamal Lewis inside the 30 to the 27. Let me go back and raise this point with you, Dave. You see the numbers on Jamal Lewis. First true freshman in Tennessee history. Over 1,000 yards, 1,021.
This is just a big run. Just watching. Leg strength, juke, planting feet. Look at the quick feet. Change direction. See the break. Pick up your blocks. Find every yard that you can get.
In this era of polls setting up the alliance for a national title, in my opinion, no coach should ever have to defend himself for running up the score. That's the flawed system that we currently have. Mark Levine is stopped about a yard behind the line of scrimmage. And the bowl picture shaping up where the SEC is concerned. And with the loss of Georgia last week, truly only one SEC team figures to make the alliance, and that would be Tennessee if they went out. And then you see the other slots. And believe me, after the Citrus Bowl, it's completely up in the air who would go Outback, Peach, or Independence Bowl. What all of those bowls have to know is they're going to get a quality SEC team. And in fact, SEC teams in the 6th, 7th, and 8th hole could be filling up other bowl games that are at large interest.
Exactly, especially with that Big East division where no one's going to have 6 for all games.
Stop near the line of scrimmage. South Carolina plays Clemson later today. They could be bowl eligible. Were they to win that game, they've been talking in Las Vegas, I'm told, about the possibility of taking a 6-5 South Carolina. The turning point in this game, you have to look at the second half. Very quickly, Peyton Manning going to Jamal Lewis.
Yeah, down the sideline. Kentucky gambling on the play, trying to run a full blitz, leaving Jamal Lewis to the outside. He ran down and got a quick score. They scored back-to-back there, and really, you see, for the Kentucky players, they realized, and it was right about in then when Tennessee took a little bit of control. But this has not been easy for Philip Fulmer.
Doubling Nash, Volunteers took advantage. Manning looking long, and finally the flag does come down against Eric Kelly, who clearly had wrapped up Marcus Nash.
I wondered if Nash had run out of bounds. That's what I thought. I wondered if he had run out of bounds. That may be what they're discussing. Was he out of bounds trying to come back in, or was he held?
Now he's trying to talk to Peyton Manning about it.
Well, the official's making a good decision. They huddle. They talk about it. What did you see? What did you see? What and a now they come up with a decision.
Defensive holding, 10 yards from the line of scrimmage, first down.
What a long day it has been for Al Ford.
Oh, boy. They've run all over the place. Again, right into your screen, you're going to see a go pattern. Manning a little roll right here, throws it deep. You see his receiver's not even anywhere close to it. Held right there about the 10-yard line. But I just think in this situation.
By the way, the ball is going to be placed. We were talking about 21 yards needed for Peyton Manning. He has 21 yards between the line of scrimmage and the end zone to tie Zion. Their all-time passing, pretty incredible. 21 yards needed. Manning 21 yards shy of tying Eric Zier for single game yards passing. Gives it to Lewis.
You know something that's incredible when you look at the number of completions. He's got over 20 yards per catch. I mean, that's incredible. I don't know the last time I saw a quarterback have 20 yards per reception. You're always going to see one of those 21 yards now we're being signaled, but you're always going to see one of those guys with 20 yards on 6 catches, but not for a quarterback.
We'll be back. 1,283 yards of total offense this afternoon's game. That's after you do the addition for those two stats. That's an amazing afternoon of college football. You know, and our thanks to these two fine institutions of higher learning. And these two outstanding offenses,
quarterbacked by, in my opinion, the Heisman Trophy winner and the heir apparent, for giving us all of the excitement. Don't forget next week, much more of it, Ole Miss and Mississippi State. The Egg Bowl, note the time change, 3:30 Eastern, 2:30 Central Time. Bob Kessling, Dave Rowe will be on hand to bring you that one. Second and 11 now, 21 yards away from tying Eric Zier's record, but he'll hand it off instead. And Lewis will score. Touchdown.
Don't you hate these defensive struggles? Hell, Mummy, it's been a long day. He says, he's saying, I got my offense, I need my defense. And his defense has just gotten tired. A little guess wrong there by the middle linebacker, Holmberg, on that play. Guesses to the weak side, it comes back to strong side. And you knew Jamal Lewis had to be a factor. What he has done, this is his third rushing touchdown today. He has one pass reception. You see him on the sideline with Peyton Manning saying, what a day, big boy. I'll tell you one thing. Peyton's got a day that his dad, Archie, never had a day like today.
59-31, and for Peyton Manning, a great day compared to Davy Crockett in the state of Tennessee. He made all the right moves. Here's one to Nash, one of three touchdown receptions for Marcus, his favorite target in today's game. And if you didn't Nash him,
you go to McCullough and get one.
And then, of course, you can always use your back out of the backfield.
Right.
And Jamal Lewis, rushing yards better than 100, but all-purpose yards even more, added to the Tennessee attack today. Marcus Nash with another marvelous catch. Peyton making all the right moves, and an appreciative Winchester native, Philip Fulmer, securing the beer barrel for yet another year. They've had it since 1984. That was the last time Kentucky won in this matchup.
And Peyton saying, you know, I think I can pass this thing. You just give me that. Today, I think he could have completed it.
You know, the history and the tradition, the beer barrel, all of this matters to Peyton. One of the reasons why he came back was because all of these items, all of these moments are so very important to him.
It's all what college football is about.
Gary Davis, again, the recipient, not calling for the fair catch.
Number 94.
This time, that's the fourth time he's had it. And the final tote board is in on Peyton Manning. 25 of 35, five touchdowns, 523 yards. You know, the happy announcers for today's game, and we are happy, are selected and compensated by Jefferson Pilot Sports. Our broadcast is a copyright presentation. Any use of this broadcast without the express permission of the Southeastern Conference and Jefferson Pilot Sports is prohibited.
Well, you think Couch is going to throw it up? Heck yeah. 58 seconds, that's an eternity for him.
East. Boy, he got hammered at the 37 by Jeff Coleman, number 92. Clock continues to tick. Couch gets them to the line of scrimmage.
Hurry up time. Jim Couch, hurry up.
Wildcats will wind up their season 5-6, 2-6 in the SEC.
When's the last time you saw a quarterback with those stats on the losing team?
Jermaine White comes up with it. And the whistle stops it up around the 40-yard line.
Did he make a first down? I think he had to make the 40-yard line. I think he's just a little bit short, so Couch better hurry. Wants to get one more toss.
It'll be my honor to see Peyton play his last game in Knoxville next week. What a remarkable career he has had. Sanford still struggling to get out of bounds. One more play. This game desperately needs one last play.
And did you see Peyton? He started across the field, and all of a sudden he had to turn around and go back.
Peyton came back. A lot at stake for Tennessee in these last two games, and that has the ball players ready for the challenge. This is why Peyton Manning is back in the Army.
Well, it's just exciting because there is so much out there to play for, and it makes these last few games exciting, and it makes practice on Mondays exciting. You know, guys come out there looking forward to working every day, whereas the past couple years It's been tough getting some of the guys motivated to play. And so just knowing what's out there, it's a lot more fun to go out there and play.
And there you see the comparison.
Gosh, that's so close to 1,000. Look at that, 995 yards passing.
Couch, you say to yourself, too, you know, if I could get a 50-yard strike here.
I need 51. 51-yard strike. And he's right at the 50-yard line. But what a day. And what a pleasure it's going to be to watch Tim Couch for the next 2 years.
No question.
Peyton Manning goes on kind of in the footsteps of his dad. He's probably one of the great college players to ever play this game of football. I know how proud his parents are. And Tim Couch, let's load him up and fire another day.
Homer comes up with it, and
hey, he got
that's going to do it.
He got the over the 5 yards. That's 1,000 yards passing today.
The beer barrel belongs to Tennessee, and they are but one conference game away from securing the SEC Eastern Division. There you see the meeting between perhaps this year's Heisman Trophy winner and the heir to his throne as a quarterback in the Southeastern Conference. Two quality young men. The reason why intercollegiate athletics is so very special. Two great examples of it. Back after a word from your local SEC station.